Welcome, welcome, welcome to another episode of Pound for Pound Boxing Report. I am your host, Michael. Joining me this week, I'm live from San Diego, Gail Falkenthaler, Communities Digital News. Live from the Midwest, MF and Brown. And also joining us from NY, Daniel Carpio, for the Inscriber, as well as Jacob Rivero, who's joining us from the West Coast. What's going on, ladies and gents?
Glad to be with y'all.
Hello.
All right, all right. For those who are new to the Pound for Pound Boxing Report, Pound for Pound Boxing Report is a live YouTube show as well as podcast and blog. If you want to find any information about Pound for Pound Boxing Report, just go to the blog page, p4pboxingreport.wordpress.com. Look to the right of the blog page. You'll find links to find us all over the interwebs. The page is on Facebook, on G+, on Tumblr, Twitter, YouTube. The link to find us on Pinterest. Find an RSS feed if you want to subscribe to us there, as well as the links to find us on Stitcher Radio, Flipboard Magazine, SoundCloud, iTunes, as well as the email address, which is p4bboxingrpt@gmail.com. And lastly, since we recently moved to SoundCloud and iTunes, the newer episodes are there, but our old episodes are still on Podomatic, so I still got the link to the page on Podomatic where you can find all old episodes of Pound for Pound Box Report. With that going, let's get the show started by recapping what went down last week. I want to start with Luis Ortiz, fast rising heavyweight. A lot of people feel he's the most dangerous guy out there in the heavyweight division. Went to D.C. to fight Tony Thompson in his hometown. Ortiz won by 6-round stoppage, three knockdowns along the way, all from the same punch, basically the left hand. Since it's been a while for you, since you've been here, Dudu Brown, I want you to open up your mic, please. I'm going to go to you first. Dudu, open up your mic, please. Okay, Ortiz won, but to me, he wasn't going at full speed. He knew that he didn't have to bring his A game, but yet he still dominated. Some people were saying that, you know, they were not impressed with Ortiz. Bad-mouthing him a little bit for his performance, but again, I thought he didn't bring his A game. He didn't fight full level. Your thoughts of the fight and your thoughts of some of the criticism that Ortiz has received post-fight.
Well, I think Ortiz, I think he just showed him a lot of respect because he wasn't there with Klitschko and then, you know what I'm saying? He was not on the game. He just showed him a lot of respect. I don't know why, because Tony, I mean, you know, Tony's not even a gatekeeper. I don't even know what you call anybody like that. I mean, he's a nice guy, I got him on my page and all, but I mean, he's done. He's been done, you know what I'm saying? He was pissing me off. I'm like, damn, go get him. He's ready for you. I mean, Tony's throwing slow punches. He was playing with him. He was able to hit him, and he was playing with him, you know what I'm saying? So that just showed me that Ortiz, it was exposed. He's hittable. You know what I'm saying? He kept popping him on his chin and shit, and Ortiz is just laying back a little bit too much for me, just waiting and waiting and waiting. He's just showing way too much. I see some, you know, he ain't all that tough. It is a matter of time for somebody big and bad get him on out of there too.
I'm gonna go to you, Gail, and you can follow up Daniel and Jacob. Your impressions of what you saw Saturday night in D.C.
Well, those of us who are fans of Ortiz and like what he's got to offer, you know, we admit, we hoped he'd show a little more to the HBO audience and land one of his spectacular knockouts early in the fight and call it a night. But there was no reason for him to do it. There was respect showed to his opponent, Thompson. I don't think respect, by saying respect because he feared him, but I do think he respects, A, the whole of his career. He is his elder, or at least we assume he is. You know, we don't really know how old Ortiz is. There's always something about those Cuban fighters. And I think he did respect the fact he was willing to get in the ring with him, make the fight. You know, they had tried to make it with a lot of other opponents. They were left a little bit high and dry when Tony Thompson came along. So without Tony, there's no fight. There's no event. So there's respect shown there. There's really no pleasure in it for Ortiz beating the snot out of a 44-year-old guy, you know, on his swan song in his hometown. He did what he needed to do. Patience is a virtue. especially at this stage of your career. That's something a lot of guys never learn. And against tougher opponents, he is going to need to learn how to be patient and work around guys who are awkward or don't want to engage. You know, it's real easy to fight something, that becomes a barn burner and a guy just presents right in front of you. He's not awkward. He's not leaning back. That's a good exercise for Ortiz. And anybody who was watching, if you saw the walk-up piece, the little video before the fight, if you saw that man box jump 4 feet straight up, that was impressive. I didn't even need to see the fight after that. I couldn't believe it. He is in very good shape, very agile for a man of his size. Very impressive.
Now I'll go to you, Daniel and Jacob, your impressions on what went down. To Doodoo Brown's point, do you think Ortiz was just too cautious? Do you agree with Gail that he was paying? Do you also agree with Doodoo Brown as well as Gail about Ortiz giving him a little bit too much respect? Or did you see something in Luis Ortiz? Was he exposed a bit here?
Not really exposed. This is a situation where if you're damned if you do and damned if you don't, unfortunately. If Ortiz would have not really knocked out Thompson in the first round, you know what people would say? People would say, it's nothing. It was Tony Thompson. Oh, Tony Thompson. He was supposed to do that. The fact that the last 6 rounds, and what's wrong with Luis Ortiz? Tony Thompson is 44 years old. He should have knocked him out in the first round.
He should have.
But like I said,
he should have went to him and knocked his ass out and got him retired. That's what he should have did. But he carried him for 6 damn rounds because he's scared because you didn't know where Klitschko. That just tells you the man got. I don't know if any of y'all ever been in the ring before, but I've been boxing off and on my whole life. I'm a fighter from my heart, from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet. If y'all ain't never been in the ring, ain't too much y'all can say about what a fighter is feeling inside the ring. Feel me? That's all I got to say. I'm just tired of fighting, talking with y'all motherfuckers that ain't never ever fought in your life. Ever. But you can't tell what the motherfucker is doing or thinking in that goddamn ring.
Well, another point.
They got nothing to do with that have a goddamn fighter. What's going through their mind and their heart in that goddamn ring? I'm telling you, that motherfucker Ortiz showed a yellow streak on his motherfucking ass against Tony Thompson.
I didn't see any yellow streak. And let's think about this. Ortiz already is starting to get a reputation as being very feared in the ring by his opponents. They don't want to go up against him without a big, big paycheck, you know, being dangled in front of him. Who else has got that problem? Ah, Gennady Golovkin. What did Golovkin do in his last fight? Oh, he let it go a few extra rounds to sow a few seeds of doubt in people's heads to say, well, maybe he could be hit. Maybe we should go after him. You know, is he playing the mongoose? You know, drawing everybody in?
That's pretty interesting point.
Could be. In which case, if that's what they were doing, that's pretty damn wily.
Well, yeah, I said this last week. I think this is a strategic move by Ortiz and his team because nobody does want to fight this guy because of the danger factor. He is very agile. He's got good punches. He could take a punch. And, you know, him going out there and blowing this guy away is only going to make fighters not want to fight him even more. And the plans that Golden Boy has for him, they want him to be on the undercard of that Con Canelo at the T-Mobile, which is going to give him big exposure, even more than he has today. So I think him going in there and showing, oh, you know, I'll get hit a little bit, you know, I'm going to let this go a little bit, that's going to entice people to want to fight him because all those people are going to start talking, like, you know, trash and saying, oh, well, he's weak, he's been exposed and whatever. So I think it was a strategy play.
Well,
Go ahead,
Danny, before
Well, that's interesting. Well, this is the thing, though. Just because it didn't beat, it's not mean that he was exposed. It is true. Look at the names.
He was exposed.
How the hell? Really? If he was exposed, I'll be honest with you. If he was exposed, then he would have lost it 20 times. That's exposed.
Fucking King Kong. He should have got his ass out within at least 3 rounds. He should have took his ass out no matter what the fuck y'all talking about. This is boxing. You feel me?
And he did.
Tell me, was he?
Did, okay.
Put,
Okay. The Thompson won any of the rounds.
What were you in such a hurry for? What? What, was your house on fire or something? You can wait three extra rounds. Big deal.
Like I said, he didn't lose any of the rounds, and it's true. Look at the names that that were thrown off when
he's going to become a manager. It don't matter. He has an interim belt. He will be somebody's manager eventually. So they can't all duck him forever. He's going to fight somebody.
He's already is the mandatory.
In the meantime, he needs to be knocking these fools out.
He already is the mandatory. He's technically the mandatory now for the winner of Fury Klitschko too.
Yeah, he's an interim WBA champion, so he's the mandatory.
I heard you were supposed to be a mandatory to Charles and Joshua.
Nope. The way that WBA tournament is set up, because of Aquindo's lawsuit, because technically it should have been Aquindo or right now Lucas Brown, though, should have been the mandatory for Fury Klitschko.
Well, let me say this. Do I think that Ortiz should have took him out earlier? Yes, I do. But that doesn't necessarily mean that he was just quote-unquote exposed. I mean, I hear your point, Duda Brown, about how he should have taken him out earlier, but I can come back and say that Deontay Wilder should have taken out Du Hoppus and Eric Molina earlier. So that can... Does that mean...
You're talking about two different fighters, two different fighting staff.
But still inferior opposition.
Wilder was knocking out people every single fight. His only fight that went the distance was a Severn.
He was knocking out bombs until he had to step up.
You're saying different styles, though. He's called different the Bronze Bomber for a reason, because he was knocking people out. Whether they were bums or not, his style is to go in there and annihilate people.
32 of them before he started getting on the scene, right? Like 32 guys he knocked out in the first round, right? Am I right or am I wrong? They were all...
No, but my point is, you just said that Tony Thompson, he's old, he's finished, he's done, right?
Yeah, he's done.
My point is this. If he's that done, if he's that old, the argument can be made that Du Hoppus and Molina on the level of Tony Thompson, maybe below, because they hadn't accomplished as much as Tony Thompson, hadn't fought the fires as Tony Thompson has, but it still took some distance for Wilder to get rid of them. That's just all I'm saying.
Well,
so
they were fighting back. They was really fighting. They was legitimately fighting back. Did we used to watch the same fight there? Molina,
no,
the
point.
Molina hit Deontay Wilder one time. I thought he almost knocked him out.
And because they were fighting back, they gave Wilder more openings.
Tony Thompson, that's my point. Nothing for him to stave off him. That's all I'm saying. Tony Wilder presented no danger to him. For him to stand off like he did during that whole boring ass fight.
And the other side is that Tony Thompson, he fought in such a defensive shell, he didn't give Ortiz any opportunity to land even significant big time blows, because the shots that took him down were all basically from one shot. They were all basically one shot.
The same punch too, the exact same punch every single time. That's the weird thing. Like
overhand left. That's all he kept doing. Overhand left. Because Tony was bending down out the way. He thought he was bending all the way out the way. That's why he got caught a couple times. But he wasn't bent all the way down out the way, and he kept getting hit with it.
Well, part of the problem.
I like Ortiz as a fighter, but I just don't think he's all
that bending bad. Tony Thompson is only the third southpaw Luis Ortiz has faced as a pro.
Man, that man's had over 100 some up fights. That man is very cool.
Yeah, but that's still a different look. It still takes an adjustment. And it was smart to get him in front of Thompson, because he has potentially a southpaw in front of him if he fights Charles Martin, who's one of the few other heavyweight southpaws. So it was a good thing for him to go through that exercise and get a few rounds in with the southpaw. Not that any of us think Martin's going to win necessarily. The other southpaw is Chagaev, who we probably thought he was going to face, and we're going to talk about that later. And he lost, but two of the few southpaws were directly, potentially, in Ortiz's path. Yeah, so it gives him a lot more to work with if he puts in a few extra rounds against a southpaw, money in the bank for a future fight.
Let's talk future here. As was mentioned, Ortiz is basically the mandatory, the top challenger for Fury eventually. He's supposed to, looks like they're setting up a fight with him to fight Ustinov sometime this summer, I think. My problem is, let me finish. My problem is that I mentioned Deontay Wilder in the comparison. My problem is, in discussing Ortiz, I was a little bit annoyed how, A, they were so quick to name, to hail Luis Ortiz as the top heavyweight in the world already. B, I didn't like how, when they're discussing all these heavyweights, that Jim Lampley especially, he had to be forced to mention Deontay Wilder's name in the conversation. I was put off by that. Here he is, Wilder, the top heavyweight in the top American heavyweight around, has a major belt. He's a name. He has marketability. And yet, Jim Lampley didn't want to mention his name. And when Max Kellerman almost forced to mention him his name, he said his name and then he kind of brushed him off as he was insignificant. So, speak to the future of Ortiz and speak to, I think, HBO's certain level of disrespect there towards Deontay Wilder. And this is for anybody.
Well, I mean, they serve respect against any black fighter. They've always been that way, though. It's not just him. It's you know what it is.
I'm not gonna say that because this is the same Jim Lampley who had a man crush on Roy Jones for years. So
that's right, and who still has one.
Wait a minute, we got boxing beef and Ryan joining us. What's going on, bro?
You're saying there's no racism in boxing.
No, I'm not saying that. But I'm not saying that. But I'm saying in Jim Lampley's case, I can't say that because he has had a mad crush on Roy Jones for a year. He was about to say something, Beats. Go ahead.
It doesn't matter what they say because Wilder has won already. Wilder was written off in the amateurs. He was written off in every stage of his pro career. He was written off against Stiverne. You know, he's one of the most exciting fighters. He doesn't get credit for that. HBO overlooking on the KO ratio where he beats Triple G. It doesn't matter. He's won already, right? They're trying to bring it into existence that this guy ain't about his business. But anyone will tell you, right? I interviewed Wilder way over 2 years before he won the title because I believed in Wilder. I saw Wilder. I believed in Wilder, right? They tried to put it into the minds of everybody. He's not going to go to Russia. He's going to vacate the belt. What? To fight Povetkin? You've got to be crazy. He's going over there to knock Povetkin out. Whether anyone likes it or not. Well, that's boxing. Don't you know what I mean? Like, what do they expect him to do? One man's got to win. Why should Wilder fear anybody with that punch? And he's improving. Why should he fear anybody? They should be fearing Wilder, right? Because he can end the fight anytime, right? And, you know, they better have some security in there because their Russian fans are not going to be happy when their boy is on the floor there, out cold. They ain't going to be too happy.
Oh, that one's going to be fun. Yeah, that one's going to be fun indeed. There's an interesting angle, actually.
If he keeps him at the end of his punches, he wins. If he don't, he gets knocked out.
That's boxing.
I'm just telling you the truth. If a boy gets inside, he's going to sleep.
Yeah, and if Wilder connects clean to him, he's going to sleep.
Well, what, 11, 12 round? Why ain't knocking people out like he used to? He ain't not in the first round. He takes like 10 rounds.
Only one of his fights went the distance. Against Stiverne.
That's Stiverne, right. I know. I've seen all this fight. I'm saying is he ain't knocking guys out in the first round like he used to. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, so but they're still getting taken out. They're still getting stopped.
Yeah, eventually.
Yeah, what, eventually or whatever. This is what, you don't have to do it in one round. Who's, it's not. It's a 12-round sport championship boxing. It's not one-round boxing.
But the highest round.
Deontay Wilder doesn't.
We're talking over each other here, one at a time, please. We're talking over each other, one at a time, please.
Look, Deontay Wilder doesn't train for one round.
He ain't all that.
Deontay Wilder doesn't train for one round. I remember you were saying about his skinny chicken legs and his that.
He do got some goddamn skin. And he broke up to his ass. I promise you. Right? They don't catch up to his ass.
Yeah, you want that to happen. That's what you want to happen.
It's going to happen. If you know anything about boxing,
that's what you want to happen.
Legs and a big top body just don't go together.
We'll see.
That last fight he fought, you saw how he was thrown around on the goddamn ground and shit because his legs? It's just a matter of time, bro.
Okay.
Let's bring everybody else into this discussion. I heard you, Shady Slim, ask what was I talking about. I was talking about the future for Ortiz and how HBO seems to already be hailing this guy, anointing this guy, as the best heavyweight in the world. One, I think that's a little bit presumptuous on their part. But two, and most importantly, I didn't like personally how Lampley, in particular, seemed reticent to bring Deontay Wilder into the discussion about the top heavyweights out there. And when he was forced to do it, but almost by Max Kellerman, he said his name, but then he brushed him off. It was like he was irrelevant. I took a little bit of offense to that. So I want your comments on that and anybody else who want to join into this discussion about the future Ortiz and HBO's indifference or attitude they have towards Deontay Wilder.
They
got to
build him up. They got to build him up.
I like Luis Ortiz, man. He's a good fighter, but I don't think you can put him in the category with Deontay Wilder just yet, man, because he hasn't fought nobody. Tony Thompson was a guy just coming in to get a check, man. You can see the man draws about to fall down. I mean, that was pathetic. One of the worst fights I ever seen in my life, man.
This guy wouldn't
let his hands go. I mean, you just saw the man. You knew he was coming just to get a check.
I think that I'm a big fan of Luis Ortiz. You know, I definitely think he has fought, you know, may not have fought the best competition, but you look back at when he fought, oh my God, I can't forget, remember his name right now, Brian Jennings. I mean, that beats everybody on Wilder's resume. Now, I mean, I see why you would say, how can they say he's better than a champion? Because in the day, Wilder isn't getting the respect that he deserves, regardless of the competition or not. He is a champion and has kept his belt for, what, four or five defenses now? We're going to his fifth defense or fourth defense. So there's got to be some respect there. The reason why he's not being mentioned by Lampley is because of the fact that he's not an HBO fighter. He's still essentially a Showtime or anti-HBO at this current moment fighter. So that's one reason he's not going to bring him up.
No. I got this. Let me get this. Whenever they talk welterweights, they're not afraid to mention Kell Brook. They're not afraid to mention other fighters from the PBC. So why not mention Wilder?
Kell Brook is not anti-HBO or anti-show. It's not anti-HBO.
But they also mention welterweights within the PBC. That's my point.
Which ones did they mention?
Thurman.
They mentioned Thurman. They mentioned Porter. They mentioned Errol Spence.
Garcia.
I mean, maybe you're right.
Danny Garcia as well. So,
my other.
So that argument, that's not a valid argument,
okay,
in my opinion.
My second argument to be why it could be that. The second argument definitely is a race-related one, which would be because Wilder does not conform to a specific stereotype. I mean, you see Wilder, what do you see Wilder? Every time I see him on TV, you see him with his little girl. You see a black father who cares about his daughter. Very rare according to TV, right? Not reality. But, you know, when you look at all these other fighters, you don't see them with their kids like you see Wilder with his kid all the time. So maybe he doesn't conform to a certain stereotype, and so he gets backlash due to that.
I don't know about that.
It's not even that, man. It's not even that.
Hakeem, I need to ask you, brother. How is Jennings better than Stavern on a resume?
Hold on a second. I got a police around me. I can't be on the phone. I can't respond. I'm in downtown LA, man. They will pull me out the car.
You deal with that cutback, bro. You deal with that cutback, bro. Get EJ into this. EJ and Dale, what's your thoughts on this? Unmute your mic, fellas. Dale, EJ.
Yo, Hakeem. I want to ask Hakeem something, man.
Yo, keep talking. Please just roll by. Keep
talking. Yeah, that's why I say he got that situation.
Oh,
so
no, can you put a little situation there? No, I'll let it slide.
No, it's good. He drove fast. No, you got to let it slide.
Propaganda
getting that, man. Got 5-0 on his neck.
Nah, man. You know if you pull your phone out, they pull you over. Beats, call at me. I'm listening.
Yeah. How is Brian Jennings better than Stavern?
What has Stavern done to be better than Brian Jennings? Brian Jennings beat Mike Perez. Who did Stavern beat? An old fat ass. I'm sorry, not old, fat Areola, who was overhyped and only beat McBride, I think, or whoever he beat. So what makes Stavern better than Brian Jennings? Brian Jennings went with Klitschko. Brian Jennings was down there with Klitschko, made him work the whole night before he fought Fury. Yeah. So how is Stavern better than Jennings? I think the
all right, now let me tell you.
The case
of
evidence should be for go on. No, sorry, go on.
Okay.
Yeah, go on.
He won he had to fight two eliminators to get his WBC belt, and he was a champion. What belt was Jennings at?
Who did he fight? Who eliminators did he fight that was better than Mike Perez?
What do you mean we fought better than Mike? Deontay
Wilder's better. Who did Stavern fight?
He lost his belt because he had to fight Deontay Wilder. That's why he lost his belt.
He would have lost the belt if he fought Brian Jennings. I'm saying that. I'm not saying that Brian Jennings is better than Wilder. I'm saying how is Stavern better than Mike Perez? Because I think Mike Perez beats Stavern. I think Brian Jennings beats
Who's Mike Perez beat then?
Mike Perez ain't going to beat no Stavern. He's the one that Alexander knocked out the first round. Right?
Who?
Little short, stocky arm dude.
He got short, stocky arms, but he... Oh, go on.
He ain't beat nobody.
He pushed Brian Jennings, but because he's crafty. But when he got in there with Sasha, he got knocked out in the first round.
Jennings ain't beating no Stavern, bro.
Okay, so you're saying Stavern would have lasted as long against Klitschko as Brian Jennings would? You said Klitschko would have knocked out Stavern?
I'm with him, man. I think Jennings is better than Stavern.
Like, is this a joke? He beat Areola. You guys remember, this is Areola he beat for a belt. I mean, it's not his
Areola
fault.
Areola don't even train, man. He don't even
he
train.
He did what he was supposed to do. He's a champion. I'll give him that respect. He did what he's supposed to do. I mean, he can't pick his opponents. That's the conventional body's choices. But at the same time, he did beat Areola for the belt.
Berman Stavern is a better puncher than Brad Jennings.
He knocked him out twice. Him in that big-ass nose.
I agree with him though. I think Jennings is better than Stavern.
There's no way that Stavern is better than Jennings.
Look at Stavern's last fight. He looked terrible.
Yeah, it's because Wilder ruined it. That's why. That's what Wilder does to careers, bro.
That's called Don King. That is called Don King.
Dehydrated some shit. He was sick. They said that man was in the hospital with piss and blood and such shit.
And Luis Ortiz had the flu, right? I mean, either way, it don't matter. You lose a fight, you lose a fight. He didn't lose a fight easily. He lost a fight badly. Spilka did better against Wilder than Stavern did.
Dale was wanting to say something. You was wanting to say something, Dale? Unmute your mic, Dale.
Yeah, Chris Areola's career ain't shit. I mean... The only guy I give him credit beating is Nagy Aguilera, a guy Huey Fury is about to fight. So yeah, I mean that's.
You gonna knock him out?
Yeah, he beat his ass in 3 rounds 5 years ago.
Wasn't Seth Mitchell unbeaten when my guy turned him over? No, he wasn't actually. Jonathan Baker.
Oh, Seth Mitchell, oh my God.
Damn it.
I'm reaching.
Yeah,
I'm
you reaching. Are. Don't bring that man this kind of discussion again, PC. That's a reach, bro. I had to get you on
that. Jonathan Banks be him.
Well, I was going to say is Jim Lampley was told to spread it to Deontay Wilder. But I think Jim Lampley don't like Deontay Wilder, so it is what it is. And Luis Ortiz, he about to fuck up Kabrat Pulev did. Other than that, I'm looking for a potential Browning versus Ortiz fight by the end of this year.
Let's move on and talk about the undercard here, because I have to say it that I got to eat some crow here. I've been talking a whole lot about Jesse Vargas, and not in a positive manner. But his fight with Saddam Ali for the vacant WBO belt that was taken from Tim Bradley. Vargas, he did the job. I thought Vargas was slightly ahead here, heading into the ninth round. Vargas stopped him in the ninth round, put him down three times, I believe. But Vargas, to me, he proved to be the stronger guy. He proved to be the harder punch. I think his punches had a harder effect on Ali than Ali's did on Vargas. And again, he's the new champion, and I have to tip my hat to him. Since EJ is muting everybody here, I'm gonna go to him first. Unmute your mic, bro.
I wanted to weigh in on that fight too when you get a chance.
Okay. First you, EJ, and then you, Shady. Your thoughts on Jesse Vargas, because you was picking him all along.
Hey, listen, bro. We trying like half an hour to get in there, boy. So wait, when I get in there, I don't want to hear no feedback. So if I mute you, it's because you get feedback. And yeah, I'm gonna glow on it. And I did tell you, Jesse's gonna beat him. You know he's gonna beat him. He's gonna whoop his ass easy. But you know what? Actually, looking at it, the fight was actually a bit more competitive than that I actually thought initially. And but I knew Jesse would win. And the reason why I had Jesse winning is I went through his resume, and his resume, he's been fighting the very best. Undefeated Josito Lopez, he was the first guy to put L on his record, and he's the first guy to put L Lucky Boy Omotosu's record, Tim Bradley fight. Yeah, he probably got a couple of rounds, but he floored Tim Bradley. That's quite impressive as well. And some other fights, you know, Khabib fight another guy. So he's fighting the very best in each weight class he's been at. Now you go to Saddam Ali, and you know, I didn't see the same. So it was simple for me. It was very easy to me to say, well, you know, Vargas gonna beat it because he's been in the better class, and that's what he did. You know, he put it on him and took him out, and all the other stuff with Jesse Vargas, like his decisions backwards and forwards. If you look at some of the fights, yeah, they could have gone either way, but he got the decision and he moves on. But look at the people he's rolled with. He had Roy Jones has been in his corner. Roy Jones was in his corner. He came up for Roger Mayweather up in Vegas. You know, he's been through some real good, had some real good trainers, had some real good camps. And finally, all the experience kicked in, and it was just way too much overwhelming for the young man, Saddam Ali. And that's why I picked him. You know, he don't come down. When I'm picking a fighter, man, I ain't got no bias. I'm going to tell you straight how it is, man. Resume, look who they fought, if they've been, how did they do in their last fight. And you know, Vargas was pissed off how what happened with him in the Bradley fight. So someone was going to get it, and they sent that to be Saddam Ali. So I have to pat myself on the back and say, you know what, EJ, you're nice. You know your boxing, so well, good. I also put Tyson Fury to beat Vladimir Klitschko. I'm going to get that one as well. And Holly Holmes to pick up Ronda Rousey. So I'm going to keep going on. So I'm on a roll. So that's all I have to say.
I'm going to go to Shady and then go to the ladies, Duda Brown and Gail. Your impressions of the fight and, you know, Jesse Vargas' performance.
You said want a cookie or something.
Go ahead, Shady.
Oh, yeah. Right. Yeah, on my channel, I picked Jesse Vargas. And the reason I picked Vargas, you got to look at the experience factor. Nothing prepares you for a fight more than experience. He fought a guy like Tim Bradley, and we can say that Jesse Vargas is an undefeated fighter when you look at the way that Bradley fight went down. He knocked Tim Bradley out with about 10 seconds left, and the ref came in and stopped it. We don't know what would have happened in them 8 to 10 seconds. So I knew
going into that.
Hold up, let me finish what I'm saying. We don't know what would have happened had Vargas been allowed to finish that fight. So you going into this fight with Saddam Ali. I wanted Saddam Ali to win, but I knew he wasn't going to win. You going into this fight with Ali, you already pissed off with what happened with Bradley. So, and Saddam Ali had never been in a big fight like this, fighting a guy like Bradley or Vargas. So I knew that was going against him, man. That's why I picked Vargas to win. But I didn't know he was going to dominate. So good call by EJ, man, and picking that Tyson Fury fight. I definitely wouldn't have picked that one. But I knew Vargas was going to win. I picked Vargas to win. That's my thoughts on it.
Doodoo Brown, Gail.
I picked Vargas because he gave Bradley a tough fight. That's the only reason. But when the first couple of fights, Saddam was doing really good. I mean, I'm like, oh, shit, I picked the wrong motherfucker. I'm like, oh, damn. And then he started coming out. I'm like, oh, God, okay, okay. That's it.
This was really a 50-50 fight, so I don't think any of us who picked the wrong guy should feel too bad about it. And good for Vargas. You know, he has gone through a lot of trainers. He's called guys out. He's still got a real hard-on for Bradley. Now he wants the winner of Bradley Pacquiao, and I think he's hoping it's Bradley and not Pacquiao just because he wants his revenge. But, you know, it looks like from the last fight in this one, he's finally found the formula. He's finally found a way to marshal some power. It's working for him. Good for him. You know, he was elated with this victory, and he should be. And this opens a lot of doors for him. It's all good. I was very amused this week to see that Top Rank, you know, they've got him front and center on their page. They're super excited about him. And they're even running a new contest to pick a new nickname for him. I don't know what prize they're giving away, but they're looking for fan suggestions for a new nickname. So I think the Pound for Power part has to come up with one because we could win that thing.
I'll figure out something. I'll go to you, Beats, and then you, Daniel and Hakim, talk about the fight and talk about in terms of the future of Jesse Vargas as well as Saddam Ali, because I don't think, look, it wasn't like Saddam Ali, he just got beat from pillar to post all fight long. I think he can come back. But I also think he needs some new trainers, maybe change camps, move somewhere else, because it was obvious that the class and experience that Jesse Vargas showed throughout the fight.
Well, I'm going to say it like this, yeah? Jesse was rolling with Broner and, you know, probably a lot of amped up cheerleaders. And sometimes they make you believe that you're something that you're
That's
not.
Saddam Ali, not just...
Yeah, I mean Saddam, sorry. Yeah, you're right. Right. And sometimes it makes you believe you're something that you're not. And it's very dangerous in boxing for young fighters. Young fighters need to be grounded, and they need to know exactly what level they're on. Yeah? So unless he humbles himself, the comeback is going to be very difficult. Yeah? And Jesse, you can see, like... the jab to the body, I don't know if anyone saw the jab to the body he was using. He got that out of the Mayweather camp because that stabilizes movers. You know what I'm saying? You know, you cut, it's hard to reset and get your punches off. And he done a grand job in there. But I will say this, though. He needs to enjoy that evening because the rest of the 147-pounders at the top end are going to be way better prepared for battle than others. Saddam Ali. If you put Jesse in with even that Chavez, if Chavez is trained, he's going to give him a war. He's got a good chance of beating him too. So he should enjoy his evening, but it all depends on if he can take some momentum off this and go further. We'll see. I'll have to see the next fight, who he fights.
Okay, so as of right now, you still have him on the bottom tier, if you will, below the Thurmans, the Brooks, the Bradleys, the Pacquiao's.
No. Yeah, he's got. That's a big win. That's a big win. So, you know, he deserves a good position amongst the top 10. But I need to see another fight against another guy a little above Saddam Ali to see if it's real.
Okay. First you, Daniel, then Hakim, then Dill.
All right. Well, the way I broke this down, this fight, was before the knockdown and after the knockdown. Because before the knockdown, that fight was pretty even. You could tell that Jesse Vargas was trying to throw the harder punches. but the more crisper combinations early on were at least coming from Ali. But he has this tendency, like Matt Cullerman noted, that he said it was a little bit like a swag fighter. He threw combinations, and then he stepped back to admire his work a little bit when he should have been probably pushing a little bit more. But that fight was pretty even. When you look at the stats, they threw the exact same percentage and landed the same exact percentage of power shots. The only difference was that Saddam Ali only threw two less. But after the knockdown, you can tell. You could tell that he was hurt, and he didn't recover even with that minute coming apart. So you got to give props to Jesse Vargas for that. He may have found now finally a trainer in a style that actually suits him better. As for the future, that's pretty murky because the only fight that you can say you can really do when it comes to unification right now is Kell Brook. Because Kell Brook is still technically a free agent when it comes to the U.S. But everybody else, to see, Thurman is still going to be tied to Porter. And we all know how Danny Garcia does his business next to his dad. So that's going to be pretty murky. So he's probably going to try to go after Bradley. Saddam Ali, I'm probably going to say, is probably take 6 months off, try to rebuild back up. He's going to have to do it the same way that Amir Mamgan is going to have to do it, which is probably going to get two or three really good fights, but it has to be against good competition before being ready for a title shot again. Because to Jay Dill's credit, I remember him saying it, that this was the first fight, 12-rounder, that Saddam Ali fought. So he may not have been completely ready for that spotlight yet, even though before that knockdown, it was a pretty even fight.
Hakim, if you got the popo off your back, man, unmute your mic, man.
Yeah, no, I got to get the popo off the back. I'm on the freeway now. What's name? You know, Jesse Vargas to me was just a better man that night. I was definitely going for Saddam Ali. Without a shadow of a doubt. But, you know, Saddam Ali really made me mad during the fight. I felt like he just wasn't defensively responsible. He seemed to keep getting hit with the same punch
all
night by Jesse Vargas.
And that right hand.
Yeah. And
which was, to Beat's point, was set up by that jab to the body.
Yeah, exactly. And what made me mad was that Saddam Ali, and I noticed that too, Beats, he seemed too cocky. He seemed as if he knew he was the better fighter, but it was not showing in the ring that he was the better fighter. He may have been the better boxer, but he was not the better fighter. And it just really showed. He kept his hands down for most of the fight, at least not where they should have been at. He didn't keep them down, but he definitely kept them not protecting his face because he kept getting hit with that right hand. I was warning when he was going to make an adjustment, just wouldn't make an adjustment, wouldn't even try to block a right hand. I mean, there was no attempt to show any type of responsibility for the right hand. It was just ridiculous. Yeah. He was doing nothing at all. Corner was looked like he gave him no instructions. I mean, it's one thing to get hit with the same punch, you know, maybe for one or two rounds. You can get hit over and over with the same punch. And every time I want to score a round for him, I mean, power sometimes really is all you need for the equalizer. And it'd be one punch, and your punch would just nullify everything Saddam Ali did. And I just couldn't give a round to somebody who's getting hit with punches that hard. I think Jesse Vargas would have beat him 10 out of 10 times. He just would.
You don't think? Let me ask you a follow-up right quick. You don't think that a possible move out of his base in New York, sparring the folks that he put into his, you don't think a possible step up in sparring and a change of scenery and a change of trainers wouldn't change anything for Saddam Ali?
You know, I thought about the trainer thing, but then again, you know, I forgot who I was listening to on a podcast, but there definitely is a toughness issue with Saddam Ali, and I felt that when I saw it. I felt that he just wasn't tough enough, and he just wasn't, when you want a fighter, rough a fighter up, he should have been doing it. I mean, he let Jesse Vargas just give it to him over up top during the clinches, and he's doing nothing. He's waiting for the referee to come save him. You got a hand loose. This is boxing. People are not going to be nice to you. They're here to punch you in the face. And Jesse Vargas was really just getting at him sometimes they were kind of mini rabbit punches, but either way, they were punches that were legal enough for the referee not to stop it, and he was doing nothing for it. He just was, to me, wasn't tough enough, and this is boxing. So far as changes, I don't think so. I don't think it would have made any difference that night.
You want to comment, Shady?
Yeah, I was about to say, I think they bought up Saddam Ali too soon. That's what I wanted to add. I think they bought him up too soon. You got to be careful with these prospects, man. You got to know when the right time to step them up. Same thing with Errol Spence. I hope they're not bringing him up too fast with Chris Algieri. You can't make a mistake and do that.
Come on, Shady. Them guys have been around for the longest. It's about time that they get their feet wet, man. They should be fighting.
You bring them up too fast, man. You can stunt their growth.
No, they got bad growth anyway. Like, get them out of here. They'll clear them out of here
Shady. Shady. I mean, Algeria is a big jump. Like, that's not a little jump. That's not a test. Algeria is a contender. That's a big jump. Algeria can literally challenge a champion if he wants to.
No, man, he ain't got no power.
I think happened with Saddam Ali, man. I think they bought him up too quick. That's what I think happened with him.
Errol Spence should be fighting Diego Chavez right now. That's who Errol Spence should be fighting, not a Chris Algieri. Chris Algieri is a step above Diego Chavez. He should be at Diego Chavez. He shouldn't be at Algieri level right now, who made Khan, you know, have issues, beat Provotnikov. I mean, this is not someone you should be fighting right now, but I'm happy for the fight either way. I'm not complaining. I mean, Errol Spence get thrown to the woods, he get thrown to the woods. It is what it is.
Dale, you want in on some of this?
I tried to tell y'all this since November, since December, since January. Saddam Ali needed to stay busy, at least get scheduled one 12-round fight or two. But y'all motherfuckers had to bring up Leon Spinks and shit like that to justify the position. Lomachenko. And I'm really talking about Jacob Rivera, because me and him go back and forth on one of these shows about it. But I just, that Francisco Santana fight told me a lot about what Saddam Ali's deficiencies were. He's a sucker for the high and low. What I mean by the high and low, feint to the body to throw a high shot up. He's a sucker for a looping shot. He keeps his head up too high. And that's what makes him easy to measure the line, a nice leading right hand or left hook. And plus, let's give Vargas credit. He adjusted to the situation. He adjusted his distance. He adjusted his range. And he was starting to land the jab a lot more. He was starting to land more combinations. And then Ali would come back with four or five punches, effective to the body. But Ali never went to the body enough because he don't like his space crowded. He likes to fight on the outside, be a bit flashy. But that's not going to cut it. And he struggles against guys who are like 5'10 or 5'11. Jesse Vargas is a big, tall frame, light welter to welterweight. Height and body frame. So when Saddam Ali fights guys his size, some of the tricks that he does won't work. He struggled against Francisco Santana. He was even Steven with a former belt holder and Jesse Vargas, now champion. And what happened was he kept on getting hit with that same looping right hand. And it was just fucking him up time after time. And he was just fighting on his back foot, but his defense became more and more porous. He was just using his feet to become his defense, but he kept keeping his arms low, his left hand low, and he was just keep on getting hit with shots. He thought his reflexes were going to help him. He thought that Pretty Ricky bullshit was going to help him, but it didn't help him. And at the end of the day, man, I found what the ref did was a bit shiesty, and I felt like he got a little bit too many privileges. Maybe it's some Golden Boy shit, but all I know is Saddam Ali, he needs to get back on the drawing board. Hopefully him and Aaron Martinez can get it on, and then hopefully he could fight Bundu. I like to see him also fight a guy like a Bundu, somebody who's tough, somebody who's game, and somebody who's not predictable.
Bundu, I think he loses to Bundu, man. It's not really losing the bundle in my eyes.
Either way, it'll just tell us what level Saddam Ali is really on. And that's what I'm going to say.
That's too stiff for Jay Dills right now. That's too stiff for Bundu. Too stiff.
So what level opponent should he try to strive for then, Beats?
Straight away, he needs to come outside the top 10. He needs some gym work. He needs to get away from them guys pumping him up and saying, you know, you're going to beat this guy easy. And then maybe towards the end of the year, Bundu, but not straight away.
Alright.
Let's talk about this HBO card was happening with the Showtime card, really the Showbox card if you ask me. Headline of that Showbox card was J. Rock Williams fighting a guy by the name of Marcelo Montano. I mean, to me, he looked like, as I said over the weekend, he looked like Pauly D from the Jersey Shore or a poor man's David Lemieux, take your pick. But this was easy work for Julian Williams, who kind of went outside of his comfort zone, started calling Jamar Charlo out and the rest of the junior middleweight landscape calling them folks out. Been a while since you talked, Beats. Talk about your impressions of J-Rock. I thought he was kind of half-assing it a bit. He didn't fight, just like Luis Ortiz, in my opinion. J-Rock, he didn't fight He didn't bring his A game because he knew he didn't need his A game in order to take this guy out. Your impressions of him, and your impressions of, again, going outside of his comfort zone, calling out Charlo, dismissing all the big names at the 154-pound division.
You see, I've been watching this thing a long time, and I've noticed with the modern day African American fighters, man, like, you know, there's a lot of talk, J-Rock, Tony Harrison, and it seems all a lot of bluster. I'm not sure. Until I see him beat someone I recognize, I ain't really got much to say on the dude, you know? He's got a lot of headlines, but what's he did? What has he did? Exactly. I look at his skill set. What separates him from, you know, a lot of other junior middleweights? What separates him? You know? I mean, I thought Charlo was going to be, not Charlo, Andrade. Andrade just gone missing. So right now, I don't think the same application is being met by the African-American fighters today. And, you know, like James Ali Bashir will tell you, I think the gyms ain't old school enough. I think these guys, they're know-it-alls, they watch a lot of stuff on YouTube, and they think they invented the wheel. So I don't know. I don't know how grounded these guys are. I don't know.
I'll go to you, Gail, and then you, Daniel. Your impression, Daniel and Shady. Your impressions on J-Rock, and speak to what Dill. Excuse me, what Beats was saying about American fighters, African American fighters, specifically, and then you can follow up. You can follow up, Dale, as well.
I'd hate to lump all a whole category of fighters in a pile like that. I do think Williams did what he had to do, and no more. And you know, we all have days like that. You know, we've all been to the gym on days that, you know, you just barely get through. You get through it. There's no real reason for it. You're not injured. You're not tired. You know, all of that, and things just, you know, don't go well for you. They're just ugly. And then there's other days you get in there and you just kill it. You're making personal records right and left. You got all the energy in the world. You know, was the former what I described, the kind of night Williams had? Was that the reason? You know, he was just not quite firing on all cylinders. You know, a spark plug was off. Who knows? But then, you know, you really shouldn't be going and backing that up with a lot of calling guys out because it makes you look a little stupid. You know the difference whether you've had a good night or a bad night. And I'm not saying you have to, you know, wallow in apologies or own it or anything like that, but at the other end, you don't start, you know, portraying yourself as all that. So I'm going to write it off to maybe not his best night, you know, but these guys anymore, you know, they if they're not fighting several times a year, they have to make the most of every opportunity. You know, no matter how bad you feel or what else has gone wrong or, you know, you had a fight with somebody, you know, a girlfriend or whatever outside the ring or you lost some money. Who knows what kind of, you know, stuff affects you, but, you know, you need to make those opportunities count. And, you know, that wasn't it. And I put him in a different category than what we just talked about regarding Luis Ortiz, because Ortiz has shown he can do it. You know, so you can make an argument that, hey, he doesn't need to waste a lot of effort on a guy like Tony Thompson. Williams isn't in that category yet, in my opinion, so he needs to make sure that people see him at his best at this point of his career. If he wants to skate later on his reputation, he can, but he doesn't have that reputation yet.
Dale, Daniel, and then...
I didn't actually see the fight. So I didn't don't know if you performed badly or not. I didn't actually.
I didn't even see that fight either, man. Because when I turned back, they had and went to the Leo Center.
Hello?
Go ahead, Dale. All
right. That fight was boring. That fight was lackluster. Williams had to do what he had to do. But at the end of the day, that guy needs to stay active. He needs to have like 3 or 4 displays before he calls out somebody legitimate in that division. And I know guys like Austin Trout has dug him or whatever you want to call it, but Austin Trout has guys in the 154 division, so I can't say much about that. But, you know, the Charlos, Williams, and Andrade, they all want these Canelos and Cotos, but Canelo and Cotto ain't trying to fight you. They trying to fight one another. So, these guys...
Excuse me, motherfucker.
Say what?
I ain't talking. You talk EJ ass up there, mute motherfucker. I'm all in UK trying to control some shit.
I mute you because you was giving feedback to Jay Dill, so okay, stay on mute.
I mute my own goddamn self, nigga.
You were giving feedback to when he was talking. He was echoing. So if you want to stay on mute, then carry on.
All right. Let me speed this up then. I just want to see, since the heavyweights are stepping it up, and since, hell, even 126, them guys stepping up a little bit, can we at least see somebody in the 154 division step it up some more as well? Like, can I see Charlo versus Andrade, or can I see Harrison versus Williams? I just want to see some fights where guys can separate themselves and they'll stop talking about their potential and their talent. They're getting older. They're almost in their 30s. So it is what it is with that. And that's all I got to say.
Well, the one guy that I didn't hear him or any other junior middleweights are talking about him right now, here's Lani Lara. And I'll just leave it at that.
And here's my part. Here's Lani Lara. Yes, it is the Lara division. That's all 154 is. It's just the Lara division. There's no real people beyond that. Just him. That's all. That's all I want to say.
Daniel, then you do the brown.
Pretty much. I kind of agree with everybody else. J-Rock just pretty much did what he had to do. Matano tried to make it a little bit dirty, but you pretty much knew who the better fight, who you knew who was going to win that fight. And, yeah, the post-fight interview was a little bit hilarious. Remember, he classified pretty much the whole division turkeys for coming into it, but, and I don't blame him either, because, like I said, Dawson Trout avoided him. I think him and Modest Mount Erosion are going to have another podcast where they're going to argue about who ducked who in that one. But, at the end of the day, like, we expected this from J-Rock. We expected him to win. And we expected him. Now he's going to be mandatory for one of the Charlos. It's Jermall, I think.
Yes.
But now we just have to see if Jermall Charlo will actually step up and now take that fight, because lately they've been saying, I can't make the weight. I may have to go up to 160. And to agree with Hakim on a certain point, the division pretty much now, based on class right now, is Arslani Lars to lose. Because nobody wants to fight him. Andre ruined himself because he decided that he valued himself too much to Jay Dill's, to one of the fights that Jay Dill wanted to see, Charlo versus Andre. What did Andre do? He priced himself out afterwards, after they agreed to the fight. And so he did that a lot to himself. So right now, it's pretty much Lara's division. Because right, as far as actual talent in the class, he's probably the best one right now among that class. Whether he moves up to middleweight or not, that's going to be a different issue.
You mentioned Lara Hakim. Well, let me just ask. Well, Doodoo Brown, you hadn't had a chance to speak on this. Unmute your mic, ma'am. We talking J-Rock Williams and that fight over the weekend. Your impressions of J-Rock Julian Williams, as well as him calling out everybody in the 154-pound division. You got your mic muted. Unmute your mic, Doodoo Brown. Doodoo Brown?
Sorry. Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
See, EJ fucked my shit up, man. Don't be fuck on my shit, EJ. No, I like him calling people out. Shit. Spice it up, you feel me? And you talking about June from the last fight?
Yeah.
Yeah, ain't nothing wrong with him. Call them all out. Shit. Ain't nobody. Charlo ain't fought the twins, they ain't fought in a minute. Boo Boo ain't fought in a minute. Call them all out. Shit.
Well, speaking of Charlo, do you think we will see Julian Williams, and this is for everybody, you think we'll see Charlo fight Julian Williams? I believe they will. I believe the fight will happen. I just don't see why it will not. I don't see an excuse why that fight should not happen. But this is for everybody. Do you think we will see that fight specifically?
Yeah, I think it's going to happen. They got to fight each other eventually. It's going to happen.
It's going to happen if they want a name. I mean, you got to fight.
You kind of went in and out. What you were saying, Hakim?
Oh, my bad. I was saying that given the fact that they're really nobodies, in my opinion, that they got to fight themselves to get themselves propelled forward if they want to make some money, notarize any type of platform within boxing. That, and if Charlo moves up, who is he going to fight? I mean, it's not like he's in a good position to win any fights at middleweight. So I think they're definitely going to fight. I mean, it's just the best fight for them, both their careers. It's kind of like a Sean Porter Thurman effect. They had to fight each other eventually, and this is going to be the same thing.
Let's move on and talk about this undercard. I can't even announce this guy's name. Advidil, whatever. He's from the Republic of Georgia. Bottom line is he came up out of nowhere, seemingly, and upset Antoine Douglas and arguably the fight of the weekend. If anybody want to jump in and chime in on that, I know you were talking, EJ, over the, he's still around. I don't think he's around anymore. But
EJ dropped off. He dropped off.
Okay. But he was talking about the style of the Georgian fighter. It was just the fight of the style that not only Douglas hadn't seen and wasn't used to, but it was a style that a lot of fighters do not fight today. So anybody want to speak on that and speak of the style of the fighter?
Yeah, he was fighting like Mike Tyson. If you look at him, he had the shorts on. The look like a little Mike Tyson. I was like, oh shit. When I was watching the fight, I said, damn, Douglas ain't fought nobody like this before, you know. And he couldn't handle it. The dude was a veteran, he was hungry, and he wanted that belt. He was gonna go through him no matter what. And the kid's still young, you feel me? He's still coming up through the ranks, you know what I'm saying? He just got out of what? Offshore box. So he couldn't deal with that guy's pressure at all. But he showed a lot of heart. He showed a lot of heart. And that's just a learning curve for him.
But my concern is, and anybody can comment later, Douglas, he took so much punishment in that fight, such a physical toll on him. It's one thing for a guy to get starched early, like Badu Jack did. My concern with Douglas is that he took so much punishment in that fight. I wonder if he's going to fully recover from that kind of beating, not just mental, but psyche as well. Anybody can comment. Unmute your mic, folks.
Yeah, that I kind of have to agree there, Mike, because unfortunately, Douglas had to be safe from himself in that fight. He wasn't going to go out on his own. And his corner, for some reason, did not see the fact that right after round eight, he was pretty much done. But I got to give props to the kid. He helped. He did maintain. He did try to fight back, and he did land some combinations. But the funny thing about this, and I think I forget pointing me out on Sunday, this was supposed to be Sam Solomon. Sam Solomon got hurt. That's how Crusader got this fight. And it's a case, it's truly a case where the substitute is a tougher test than the guy you were supposed to fight. But it may be a good lesson for Douglas, because he now knows that there are fighters like this who are going to come and pressure you no matter what. It doesn't matter that you have a reach advantage, height advantage, or skill advantage. They're just going to come in and try to bulldoze you no matter what, which is what Crusader did. At a certain point, he just didn't stop. I think one of the commentators, Steve Farhart, mentioned, I think around the 10th round, that Crusader was landing so many shots, he was just looking at the ref saying, hey, you got to stop this, because he's not stopping. Now, Douglas is not going down. He's not stopping. And ultimately, it's a Douglas did go down, but it's a good learning experience for Douglas, though. He's going to have to learn now that, okay, I may not have been ready for this type of style, but I got to get ready soon. I'm still 23 years old. I can still recover from this. Fully recover, I don't know. I'm agree with you there, Mike, because it's really, really hard to recover from that type of beating.
I see you back, EJ. I'll mute your mic. I was mentioning how I was listening to you guys over the weekend, and you were talking about this Antoine Douglas fight against Curtsia. And you was mentioning how Douglas wasn't used to the style that the Georgian fighter fought, who fought like a little mini Mike Tyson. Let me finish. But you was making also a larger argument about how up-and-coming fighters in general today, they do a poor job of training for all kinds of styles. And you saw an example of this in this fight. Speak on it right quick.
I haven't seen it.
So oh, I thought you saw the fight.
No, I didn't see it. I haven't seen it. That was Natty. I haven't seen the fight. Not
oh, okay.
Yeah. So what I want to know, was this Antoine Douglas meant to be somebody? Because everybody's making a big deal that he got beat up. Was he meant to be somebody?
Given the fact that he was going to fight Sam Solomon, who was just a champion not too long ago, my answer to that would be yes.
If he won this fight, he might have become the mandatory for Billy Joe Saunders, I think.
Yeah. So he was being touted. So anybody else want to comment on this fight with Douglas losing, getting upset?
You know, these young guys do have to be protected from themselves. They want to give it their all. I appreciate that, but I never, ever second-guess a referee stopping a fight. And I want them to stop it too early instead of too late. And the problem is they take so much heat from the fans in particular. They hear it. They know when the fans are getting on their case. Oh, you stopped it. Oh, you shouldn't have stopped it. I never publicly criticize a referee for stopping a fight, because you get into a situation like this and they think, well, you know, he wants to keep going and everybody's enjoying it and I want to give him a chance and he's a young guy. But at the end, you know, there's a long life after boxing for all these guys, and we know too much about head injuries now to really let that stuff go down like that. And once you get past two-thirds of the way through the fight, If you in your heart believe the guy isn't capable of a knockout at that point against his opponent and he's that far down on the cards, you need to stop the fight. Should have been stopped two rounds earlier.
Well, I saw highlights of the fight. He didn't take no worse beating than Archie Moore did against Yvonne Durrell, and Archie turned that around. Boxers, that's what they're there for. They're there to fight and take punishment. And the reason it is the phenomenon, the spectacle it is because it is risky. It is a near-death experience at times. That's the whole point, you know? So I don't agree that you can't open. You can't critique referees. Then somebody stopped the fight too early. And that's the truth. Some do stop the fight too early.
I'd rather they do that than stop it too late. You know, that's somebody's son, brother, husband out there, and it's unnecessary. You know, these guys are fighting. These guys are fighting for our entertainment. Let's not make it anything more. They are fighting for our entertainment. I don't want someone dying for my entertainment. I appreciate what they do. They're trying to earn a living, but that it is not unnecessary. You know, in 5 or 10 or 20 years from now, is it going to matter to you? No. Is it going to matter to me? No. Is it going to matter to him if he's all messed up from it? You bet it is.
He's going to be okay. I got him on my page, Facebook page.
We hope so, but we don't know. Look what we've learned about football players.
You CTE. Know,
that's right. We are not going to know whether he's right with himself for 20 years.
Actually, until he's dead. Then they can't figure out they're dead. They pull the brain out.
That's absolutely right. And this was not – if this was the fight of the century, you know, if this was the pinnacle of someone's career – you know, I could make another argument for letting it go. This is a young guy. This was, in the scheme of things, not a big fight. Absolutely unnecessary to let someone take that punishment. You know,
I think it comes down
for what was a few $1,000. You know, ridiculous.
I think it comes down to how much blood and how much pain do we really want to see. And sometimes that side of us as human beings can get very ugly. And I think boxing shows that when people want to have a fight stop too early, they get mad. But like you said, at the end of the day, no one wants to talk like Hitman Hearns later on in life. But at the end of the day, Beats is right that you did sign up for a punishment and you knew, you know, boxing has contracts. You know what you get into when you go in that ring. If you die, you are only the person liable for that decision. So, but there has to be a line drawn, and sometimes – you know, it's the referee's job to make sure that line is drawn. And, I mean, I'd rather be a referee who stopped the fight early than be a referee who quit my job because the person died in the ring.
Absolutely right. And let's remember, a guy in that condition is in no position to make a judgment about himself whether he can go forward or not. That's the whole point of having a referee, of having a ringside physician, and all the protections in place. Because sometimes you do have to protect a guy from himself. That is the situation.
90% of ambitious boxers don't know when it's soon enough to stop, because they go in there to fight and win, and they're prepared to put their body through the motion of that. That's the whole point, you know.
And we do love that. We love that attitude.
They say to make an omelet, you have to crack a few shells. Even if you stop fights early, fighters are going to be talking like Hitman Hearns or like Terry Norris, because it's punches to the head, basically. So,
you're not going to solve this argument tonight, but I would argue that is not necessary. It's not.
Okay. But I agree with Beats on one point, that there is definitely a way to delay the progression like you're saying, as far as referee stopping the fight. But Beats is right. They did a study on boxers, and 100% had CTE. I mean, that's the highest, higher than football. They're going to get CTE regardless. And that's not going to stop, you know, us from watching boxing. No, nor is going to stop football, who took a religious day for Christians. Okay, so
it depends who it is, though, because when it's Margarito getting a vignette, everyone's for it when he lost his eye. Yeah, man, beat him up, like let Cotto beat him up, let Pacquiao take out his eye. That's all right, because he's supposed to be cheating. Or what about Jesse Vargas if he lost the fight the weekend? That would have been all right if he got beat down as well. So it depends on the person. If we like the fighter, then it's like, oh, it's really bad. But we dislike the fight. He got what he deserved. Now, people need to be like, you know what I mean? End of the day, yeah, it is what it is. It's the
game. My problem with that argument is that...
One minute, Michael. You go in there, you know what you go in there for, and depending if you got a crook referee like that guy from Texas, you know what I'm talking about, that, you know, that referee, that thingy son. Was he there?
Vic son. Not Vic.
You know what I'm talking. Yeah, if you get him as a referee, you know someone's gonna get killed in there. So boxing, you never know what you're gonna get. That's what I'll say. Go ahead, Michael.
I was gonna say, I don't know if Margarito is a good argument, particularly now, given what we know the issues that he has. I mean, you saw that fight. I don't want to talk about that fight with Pius. I mean, but you saw how Margarito.
It's a good fight. I enjoyed that fight. I'd recommend.
But look, man. One of his eye looked. It looked way too big, and the other one looked way too small. And we know he has damage, and for him to take that kind of punishment, I don't know if I want to see that.
What's his name again? What's that middleweight guy that won years ago with one eye? Loads of fighters fought with one eye, man.
You talk about Sugar Ray Seals?
No, I'm not talking about it. Harry Gripp fought with one eye. Loads of fighters, man. That's what they go in there for. Marco Rico's got, he's got bills. That's the only way he knows how to make money. And I'm guaranteed that was a very good fight against Pius, Jorge Pius Jr. Man, that was a very entertaining fight, man. Trust me, bro. But I'm just trying to say, this is what he is. They're going to fight at one eye. They're going bro, they're going to go in. That's how they are, man. They're fighters. Listen, they're going into the arms drop-off. You know, that's what Roy Jones is doing. Still continuing his career.
Like, Roy Jones is showing significant signs of CTE,
significant signs of CTE. Nah, he's a fighter at heart. They will continue. Like, it's too much. But what I'm trying to say, they will continue until someone saves them from themselves. Evander Holyfield will still try and fight now, but no one will give him a license. So that's what I'm saying, man.
And you see, the thing is, right, that when you see a fighter take a bad beating, you might not want to hear it, but it's a template for young fighters. When you see Dennis Levitev take that beating against Guillermo Jones, it's showing the young fighter, this is what you're going to have to push yourself through. Do you really want to do this? You know? And Levitev was glad to do it because he didn't want to let the Russian crowd down. The Russian crowd didn't want the fight stopped because they wanted the Russian guy to win. This is the pain game, man. This is where it's coming from. This is the lineage of gladiatorial, you know, stuff that used to happen in the Roman Empire days, man. This is what it is, you know?
But to his point about Margarito, the difference is Margarito's up there in age. Douglas is 23 years old. So he's young enough and strong enough to recover. You cannot say that about a Margarito who's fighting now and taking beatings like this and in tough fights like this.
I was talking about the comparison there is like, we don't know where he's going to. You're assuming that we don't know how much mental damage it takes. Like, that's what I'm saying. Margarito's mentally strong. This guy's a young guy and he took a beating. Let's see what he does next. We don't know. He might say, you know what, dude, Victor Ortiz, you know what, I don't need to be beaten up no more. I might retire. You don't know. You don't never know, man. But all it is, he got tested at that level where he didn't like it. Let's see what he does next.
Yeah, let's move on. And I was going to talk about some more fights, but the show is running kind of long here. So let's get into some news development. In talking about Luis Ortiz, it was mentioned that Deontay Wilder-Povetkin fight coming up. Well, we now know that fight is going to happen in Russia. I believe BCU was mentioning that fight. A lot of back and forth among the YTBC, whether if the fight would land in Russia, would Wilder take the fight? He indeed has. I think this speaks a lot to him. Well, to me, if he was going to fight anyway, regardless, eventually at the end of the day, because you just won the belt, you're not going to give it up. So speak to the fact that, one, we're going to see the fight, and two, we're going to see the fight in Russia, Beast.
Look, man, he won that belt for his daughter. He ain't giving up that belt. People wanted him to give it up. I don't know what it is about Wilder. People are almost willing him to come into existence, that he can't fight. No, he can fight. He's one of the biggest heavyweight punchers. He's going over to Russia. He's going to prepare well with Deeds and Breland, and he's going to knock Povetkin out. And like I said, they better have good security because the Russian crowd is not going to like what's going to happen. They're not going to like it. Wilder was never scared to go there. Never. Never. He ain't scared of no heavyweight. Why should he be?
Yep, that's right. Tell him.
Not to get inside of him, he will knock him out. He will capitalize like everybody else that got inside of him and popped him and kind of threw him off for a loop, but they really couldn't capitalize on hitting him, hurting him. Sasha's going to capitalize on him if he gets inside of him. But if he keeps him on the outside, yeah, I can see him getting knocked down and possibly knocked out. But if he gets inside, Jack, it's over. I'm telling you. And you heard it from Dude
Grandma. Man, I'm American and I'm going for my American heavyweight, man. We had one in a long time. I'll be damned if I go against him, man. America, that's all I got.
Wilder, right? Go to Russia and pull this off. We got to call him the black Rocky if he pull this off in Russia.
We call him the Black Cold War, man. He go over there to fight the Cold War for us. He go over there to fight the Cold War.
He ain't go over there, right? There ain't no money going in my motherfucking pocket.
Well, Wilder's already fought 3 times in Russia in the amateur, so this is not going to be anything new to him. When it comes down to that crowd, is going to come into it. But I'm glad it's happening, first of all.
He's going to have to knock him out. He ain't leaving out that belt on no point. I tell you that right now. He has to knock him out. No doubt about it. All his other fights, this fight, he has to knock this motherfucker out.
Yeah. One thing I see about Wilder, though, when it comes down to it, he does tend to fight to the level of his competition. Because the best fight he had was still with Stavern, and you saw what he did with Stavern. He used that jab. He used the distance. to make sure that Stubborn wasn't able to club him that well.
He got the great jab, but people are still able to get inside. You know what I'm saying? He got some holes. He's a good fighter. Don't get me wrong. Everybody, oh, I don't hate him, but I see a lot of weak. I see a lot of holes. I see some shit that people can capitalize that got some real skill. You know what I'm saying? And Sasha ain't no joke.
Oh, absolutely. That's why this fight with Povetkin is so interesting, because he has the pedigree to do it. At the same time, the water has the height. Yeah, at the same time, the water has that right hand, and he does have that height advantage and the reach advantage. So it's going to be an interesting fight. Like I said, I'm first glad it's happening. I think the main reason why people thought they were going to drop it off is because they thought he was going to do like Peter Quillen, where Heyman is the one ordering him to drop the belt rather than do business. Wilder's one of those rare cases in the PBC where you cannot do that with, and he's not going to be it. Like, to beat Boxing Beats Ransom's point, he's there with his daughter every day. He's there winning that belt. That he has inspiration to keep that belt on top of being an American, the heavyweight that could
all
easily
fight for something.
Yeah, yeah. And this especially, he could easily almost unify the division by the end of the year, because he wants to fight four times a year. So he could, if we could clear this fight right now with Povetkin, if by some miracle Charles Martin beats Anthony Joshua on April 9th.
Miracle? Charles,
you gotta do that damn chance. Joshua has to do the same thing too. I personally think Charles Martin is going to be sacrificed to Anthony Joshua.
Oh, come on, man.
Charles
Martin.
And Lightfoot.
Oh man, Charles Martin, he gonna knock out Andy Joshua.
Stop dreaming,
AJ. Stop dreaming.
AJ gonna get gassed out about the fifth round, and he gonna.
I'm gonna come back here, yeah, because I'm gonna cover the whole. I've got press pass to the whole thing, yeah. I'm gonna come back here, and I'm gonna tell you, I told you so. I'm gonna tell you, I told you so. Like, he's got the best.
Charles Martin is gonna win, Jack. I'm telling
you. Get that crow plate ready.
Hey, let me listen to this.
I'm telling you.
You go eat the crow feet. Listen to this, right? He's got Henry Tillman. He's got some good sparring partners. He ain't gonna come off the lose. He's gonna drag Andy Joshua in deep waters. He's gonna drown him. It's pure and simple. That's what's gonna happen. Andy Joshua.
EJ, are you British?
He's
starting to really
want.
Yes.
He's very British.
Yeah. EJ does a lot of things to try to get the port out of the UK.
You guys getting black Deontay Wilder and Brady. You should be standing
Wilder,
up for your AJ, man.
Wilder's my dude, man. Listen, bro.
You got to keep in mind now he's not a Kell Brook fan either, so.
I'm not stand Kell Brook, man. He was that head couple before. And you know why already? He was Michael Brook. He's busy. Hey, come on. You know, listen. This was going to happen. Wilder was never going to give up his belt, and the Kid Quillen thing paralyzes. It doesn't really wash you in, because Kid Quillen was defending his belt like five times. The only time he defended it was Kolbov. He thought, you know what, I don't even like it. Nah, I'm not even on that. He didn't even see it as a challenge. That's the reason why he gave it up. He didn't just get the belt and
also
give it.
Also, remember, he had personal reasons, too. He had
and
personal
then, well, with Wilder, in the belt, Wilder in the OPC belt when he got the belt. Me and Beats talked to this dude, bro. This is before he was a champion. Bro, we know what this dude's about. He goes, he's a world champion. He said to us, right, when we interviewed him, he said, I'm going to defend the belt in every country. I'm not going to be the America's champion. I'm going to defend my belt all over the world. So he'll go wherever. You already see he's come to England, beat Audley Harrison. He'll go wherever. So we already knew he was going to go and fight there. And he's going to look at Duda Brown to address your comments about the infight. He knows how to do that too. Mark Brennan and when we talked to him, he goes, I know how to infight as well. I know how to hold. I know how to fight inside. I know exactly how to deal with him, man. There's no way Povetkin. I don't see Povetkin winning the fight. He gets brutally knocked out, and Peace is right. They better have security over there, bro. Because they're going to try to kill him over there, bro.
That's going to be a fun fight.
My problem is that Povetkin, he fights in large part points. He had the large segments of each fight where he's inactive, if it goes distance. And if Wilder can keep that jab going, can keep giving him angles, I just don't see Povetkin. Yes, he has power, but he got to get there. And there are large moments during the fight where
Povetkin is not. And you can get inside of him. Everybody gets inside of him. You can get inside of him. Every fight, You can get inside of him. They can't capitalize. When they get inside, they can't capitalize on it. Sasha will. Only take one punch from him. You see what the fuck he did to Mike Perez? Shit.
That doesn't compare. Come on now. Come on. Come on.
I'm just saying, as punching power, the man got power.
But you got to get there with the power. You got to get there with the power.
I mean, Povetkin,
right.
I mean, sir, not
all right,
Wilder
nobody
does.
Get inside of Deontay Wilder. He's the baddest motherfucking heavyweight on the goddamn planet.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that. But that
yes, he is. Yes, he is.
I'm not saying that, but that doesn't necessarily mean.
He never gonna get lit. Ever.
No, I'm not saying that.
Let's be honest.
But that doesn't necessarily mean that Povetkin gonna beat this dude.
Wilder
I don't give a nut. Everybody you pick, you lose, bro. Everybody you pick, you lose.
And you lost some fights too now on the show. Well, you had to eat food as well, so.
Way worse than that. Leave that. Shit, your position got to be like
Wilder fights. Wilder fights to the competition of his opponent, so you know Wilder may come out full of Stavern and just outclass Povetkin. We really don't know. It depends what Wilder wants to show up.
Stavern almost knocked his ass out like two times.
Wilder, he
just been eating this shit, but he gonna find he gonna come up some
every round.
Yo, anybody know if this fight gonna be on pay per view or is it on PBC?
It hasn't been announced yet.
I don't think it's gonna be no pay. It's gonna be like an HBO or Showtime or some shit.
That's the key. That's the key though, because
Wilder is not that big, you know, pay per view.
Oh, no, it probably won't be pay-per-view. But the thing about it, this is the interesting thing, though. Because Povetkin's promoter is the one in charge, this could wind up on HBO instead of Showtime.
Yeah, either HBO.
If it goes on HBO, it's going to be a really high number of views, man. HBO is better than Showtime when it comes to you being able to push fights. And I think that Wilder needs the HBO, HBO exposure.
If it goes on HBO, I want to know their reaction throughout the fight, given how they barely acknowledge him beforehand, how they're going to handle it once if the fight's on HBO.
Hey, it doesn't matter because Wilder going to mention it in the post fight. He ain't scared of nobody. He going to mention it right there in the post fight. You didn't miss me, Jim Lappin. I just knocked him out in front of you. I mean, I want to see Wilder just go off on Jim Lappin in the post fight. I would love to see that. Just like Floyd Mayweather did. Remember when Floyd Mayweather, Jim like pissed off Floyd? No, was it?
That was Larry Merchant.
Larry Merchant. My bad.
That was after the same thing. Years and
take
years
that
ago.
Mic away and say you never gave me a chance.
No, he told me he's going to whoop his ass.
They ain't that important. It's all about Wilder and Povetkin. And he's got to watch out for Rosada as well. I don't trust. But I believe the British Boxing Board of Control might be doing the doping. They might be taking over for Rosada while they're cleaning up. So hopefully that is the situation.
Let's talk Regal here. He was supposed to fight over the weekend in the UK. The fight's been canceled due to visa issues. A lot of confusion here. Do anybody here knows what's really going on with that situation?
This is what happened,
doesn't it?
Frank
Warren didn't come over. Yeah, Frank Warren done that to boost up sales for his fight, and he knew that they won't bring him in. They did the same thing to Vivian Harris. They boost up sales and make out like they didn't get the visa. That's what they did, man. I told you, crook, man. Told you the crook. They realized Rigo wasn't falling for the okie doke coming early, and they're gonna put Rigo in a mess in one of them silly hotels. Make sure he eats some dodgy food, and then that's what they gonna do. Now that they were gonna do that, and they were gonna put him in a shabby hotel. When Rock Nation came over, it's not.
EJ, let me in your house, man. Let me in your house, EJ. Let me stay at your house.
Nah. I ain't doing that with Rigo, bro. Like, Rigo. Rock Nation was coming over, and they had it all sorted out. They had the hotel. They had training thing. They had it all sorted out. Franklin got scared. He said, oh, you going to kill our boy, Jazz Dick. Rigo going to kill him. Said, nah, you know what? We ain't even sorting out your visa. That's what they did, man. And that's what Frank Warren's about, the dodgy guy. Beast, would be cool. He's a dodgy car salesman. That's what he is, man. That's what he is.
Yeah, it's a weird situation because they didn't grant him the visa in Russia, but he was allowed to fly back to Miami. You know what I mean?
But I thought you couldn't do that when you have visa situations.
That's what everyone is wondering. I managed to do that.
I thought he has American citizenship. Once Cubans cross the water, so they hit Florida, don't they have right to citizenship, if I remember?
As somebody that's from dealt with a lot of Cubans, the situation that works is they have a special immigration status that expedites the process of citizenship. But the thing with Regal was mainly he had to go to Russia because his trainer was training Ruslan Chekhov. And his trainer said, I didn't feel right just leaving my guy there while I go train this guy, so I brought him over. And the whole situation got turned in. Now, you're allowed to fly back to the country of your citizenship when you have a visa issue. So he was allowed to go back to the U.S. I don't know what the situation is. EJ may have a point there because Frank Warren does have a bit of a reputation now. So it may just be like Frank Warren just saw the Vivian Harris going to whip his ass and
happened. Yeah, he did with Vivian Harris. We talked to Vivian Harris. Me and Beats had it all set up. We was going to go ringside. Beats was doing his music for him. I was going to go ringside, hold Vivian Harris's belt, whatever belt it was. We had it all planned out. The night he comes there, they said he had a shadow on his brain, and they said he couldn't fight. He said, why we get a second opinion? They said, no, you can't fight. So they gave him money to go right back. And now they almost damaged his career. Obviously, I had an interview with him. I put it out there to say that he's all right. Then he had a scan, had another interview with him, and he continued his career. And then he went to Mexico, and he beat Jorge Pires Jr., the one Margarito face. Like, everyone who's damaged that fight is Jorge Pires Jr. So anyway, he went on to beat him. And whatever the rest of history ever. So Frank Warren has done this before, so I'm not surprised this has happened. In fact, I'm happy because I don't trust Frank Warren. And he was saying that Regal was going to be upset as well. But when he realized they had a whole training camp and they were going to hotel, Frank said, no, you're going to kill our boy. I can't afford that. So that's what he did, in my opinion. It's not fact. Just give him my opinion.
Let's move on and talk about a non-boxing related issue, the UFC. As the face of UFC right now, Conor McGregor got stopped by Nate Diaz over the weekend, stopped in the second round on that same card. Holly Holm lost to Miesha Tate. I'm going to go to you, Gail, on this one first. Let's talk about Holly Holm and that fight with Tate. Holm, you know, she moved around a lot. I thought she had control of the fight. Round two, she was on the ground. Getting choked. She eventually got choked out in the fifth round. Talk about that fight right quick, as well as talking about Conor McGregor. Too many folks getting his comeuppance.
Holly Holm put on a good fight. You know, a lot of fighters are winning until they're not, and that's what happened to her. She was winning until Miesha Tate was winning. So we have a changing of the guard yet again. She owned it. She certainly handled defeat a whole lot better than her previous opponent did, which has been pointed out several times that she owned it and she'll be fine. This is all to the good for women's combat sports. I'm pleased to see all the talk, all the excitement, a lot of folks watching these women, getting to know their names, a lot of changing of the guard, no one dominant name, which, you know, is exciting, but to a point it really shuts a lot of other women athletes out who deserve a little time getting attention. So now Miesha Tate's in the rotation, and Holly will be back. Rhonda, interesting. I'm not quite sure what her fate is. She was really, really broken by her defeat, and it remains to be seen for her. McGregor, we talked a little about this before the show, and I'll get this discussion started, and I'm sure it's going to light right up. You know, he went up several weight classes for this fight, and he went up a lot of weight. So it turned out to be not the best idea for him. A lot of the people who think he's a brash Floyd Mayweather type of combat sports, you know, big mouth, likes himself, not afraid to talk. You know, a lot of people like to see a guy like that get taken down a notch. He has made the sport exciting. He's drawn exactly like Floyd does. So I have no hate for him at all.
Ever compare him against Floyd Mayweather, a fucking boxer.
Let's go to you on this one, Doodle Brown. I think you share the assessment in terms of...
Compare boxing and MMA. This is two fucking different things. Totally. Can't even put them in the same fucking bag, yo. Anyway, Holly Holm, yep, she did. Yeah, she got beat. Whatever. Misha Tate lost to Ronda Rousey twice. So the next fight is gonna be against Ronda and Misha Tate. And Ronda may well, you know, win the belt again because she did beat Misha Tate twice. But anyway, Connor, yeah, I just didn't like the guy. I liked him at first. He just started rubbing me off with this, oh, I'm better than everybody. I'm God. You might as well just, I'm Jesus and all this. That's when he started blowing me off. And Floyd ain't never went there. You know what I'm saying? This guy was just like, I don't know what the fuck he was on. I think he's on crack or something. But I'm glad he got beat. Shit, I knew Nick. I said if he got down on the ground with Nick, it was over. It was over. And when he got on that ground, that was it, Jack. I'm telling you, he fucked him up. He tapped out quick.
I'm going to go to you, EJ, and then you, Daniel. You went to YouTube straight after the fight, basically talking stone cold shit about McGregor. And basically it was a fight of Diaz. You knew he was too big for Conor McGregor, took the punishment. And once you know to Dudu's point, he got to him with some shots and got him on the ground. It was over. But to me, Dudu Brown is right. The reason I talk about this because of the comparisons that, and the shade, quite frankly, that MMA, particularly those within the UFC, love to throw at the sport. And for me, in the aftermath, for folks who want to give Conor McGregor so much cred for moving up to fight Nate Diaz, okay, you can do that, fine. But then don't talk so much mess about Roy Jones when he moved up to heavyweight and beat John Ruiz. That's all I'm saying.
Mm-hmm. Well, Dana White's cash cow's gone. Ronda Rousey's gone. And there's another one. There's another Sage. Another guy, Sage. He got beat as well. And listen, bro. this made me laugh. Conor McGregor, I like Conor McGregor, yeah, but he was talking that cash money shit. But, bro, when you start saying you can beat up Floyd like Ronnie Rousey, and what all it is with these MMA guys, they want to talk about Floyd, oh, yeah, like that, and you know, he's not a man like me, and they start talking that, and then they got to the point where this guy's so arrogant that you're going to say, I'll fight any, I'll tell Dana.
Let me stop you right there. Excuse me for interrupting. I want to make a note how Holm showed more heart and that she fought to the end. Didn't tap out, but McGregor did. Proceed.
That, you know what, on that tip, I disagree. Because I don't think it's big to just sit there and get submitted. First of all, when someone gives you a rear naked choke, they crush your larynx. Yeah, you can't breathe. You can't talk properly for weeks. Why would you want to let someone do that to you? I think what Conor did was right. In that sport, you practice in the gym to tap out when you're going to get big. What? So if someone gives you the leg lock, you're not going to tap out to be brave.
But my point is, that's a boxing mentality. She calls it boxing mentality.
No, tap out, man.
Nothing to do with that. She got choked out, yeah? When she threw her on the back of her head, if you asked in the interview, she wanted to tap out. But she wanted to tap out, but she thought she was doing it. But she's already blacking out already when she threw her over. So for me, I don't take this is my opinion. I don't think it's any big thing for someone to let you choke out. That's not a good thing, man. That's not good. Like, so Conor did the right thing. Another thing as well,
immediately?
Yeah.
On the ground and immediately, yeah. Like, I want none. I'm done. Well,
let me get you in the chokehold.
Particularly for someone.
He wasn't getting out of that chokehold.
Let me get you in the chokehold.
But the problem is, he talks so much mess. He says he'll do this, he'll do that.
I'm getting to that. That's what I'm trying to get at. I'm trying to tell you, this is where he went wrong. Not that where he tapped. That's in that sport, that's what you're supposed to do. Talking about the cash money shit, he was talking about Floyd. He actually said he'll knock out Jesus Christ. Yeah, and some religious people don't like that. And he was just talking like he was the baddest man on the planet. And he said, I'll fight anyone. And people loved the arrogance, the bravado. They loved it. It was just like, yeah. But Nate Diaz, he thought Nate Diaz was a sacrificial lamb. Nate Diaz didn't even have a bloody week training camp, 2 week training camp for that fight. He came in, he was fat. He couldn't even make the weight. They was supposed to, you know, he was supposed to fight a lightweight Conor. So he went all the way up to world. But that's the only reason why. He would have fought him at lightweight, but he said, oh, I'm just going to fight anyone. So they put him in corner, went in there. He thought Nate was going to be a bomb. He thought he was going to knock him out. Went in there, and he was winning the first two rounds. He blooded up Nate's face, but Nate was hanging in there. Like the bigger guy did, the punches weren't hurt. They were hurting him, but not too much. And Nate was still in it. You know what Nate did in that fight? Nate started bitch slapping him. Punched him one hand, slapping him in the other. Then, yeah, Conor got shook up by one of them slaps. He got dizzy. He tried to shoot. That means grab him for the legs, try to almost like a bloody American football charge. He tried to bloody, what did I call it again? Anyway.
A tackle.
He tried to tackle him. Good man. He tried to tackle him. And as he was trying to tackle him, Nate Diaz got his arm around his neck, threw him over. Connor tried to roll over on his back. And then he turned over on his front and he started pounding him out and he choked him out. And he tapped. Good tap. You damn right you're going to fucking tap. Well, if you didn't tap, we're going to crush you. Nate Diaz want to make him go to sleep and embarrass him even more. It's embarrassing to go out. But, hey, Holly Holmes is a fighter. No credit took away from Holly Holmes. But Holly Holmes and the thing, Dana White threw Holly Holmes underneath the bus the moment she beat Ronda Rousey. He never promoted her. Holly was doing her own promotion. She saw her with Floyd Mayweather and all that. They didn't want to promote her. Even her fight with Miesha Tate, they didn't even promote that. They basically, that fight was just like, oh, no one really cares. And then that fight was turned into one of the best fights you ever saw. Strategy, Miesha Cupcake Tate, by the way, that's her name. She did a great strategy. Holly Holmes was winning the fight. But what was Holly Holmes Miesha was so patient. Holly kind of wanted to kind of stop her, and she got a bit too aggressive. And what Miesha Tate did, she grabbed her by her waist, crawled up her back, and got in the same chokehold. Then Holly jumped on her, dumped on her head, and then she got choked out, and that happens, yeah? But what great fights. And you know what? It's rarely like you have boxing and MMA people can talk about, but I think that's the way forward. You need to talk about MMA sometimes if they have good fights, and boxing if they're good fights. So good, big up to Michael talking on the Pound for Pound, but it was a great fight, and Conor got what he deserved, but I want to see him again and see what happens next.
I want to ask you guys a quick question. Now that Conor McGregor got exposed, who you think would win in the MMA fight out of him and Floyd Mayweather?
Two different sports. I can't.
Just say hypothetically, if it ever happened, who would you pick?
Floyd Mayweather would kick his ass.
I don't even like making that comparison because to do the Brown is two different sports. You can't make it, so I don't even like going.
He's a six. He's undefeated. I'm going with the undefeated guy. He'll find a way to win, bro. He'll keep pecking and poking. And keep giving them count. When Conor McGregor comes with his wise stuff, he'll catch him in that checker and knock him out. He got exposed, man. He ain't that good. It's a big laugh, my braggart. I'm going with Money Mayweather. That's me.
Well, yeah, can I jump in?
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead.
I see Pacquiao, like, lose conclusively on points to Eric Morales. He's been knocked out with body shots. Yeah? And they still put this guy on the same level as the best boxer in the last 25 odd years. They put this angry looking girl, who I don't know none of her opponents, on the same level saying he can beat her, and the mainstream media was alright with it. This guy Connor, how much times has he lost? What's he done in this sport? Right? They're very comfortable putting these dudes on the same level as this guy. And it just shows what the mainstream media is all about. And to answer your question, what you first said about who's the face of the UFC, well, it ain't Nate Diaz, it ain't Ronda Rousey, and it ain't Conor McGregor. It is Dana White. It's Dana White. Dana White is the face of the UFC. Dana White thinks he's this remarkable dude, and that if he stays silent, that UFC will disappear. No, it won't, actually. If you put on good fights, good shows, the people will turn up. No one cares about you, Dana. You, Dana's the face of UFC, basically. And that's why he's promoting these guys stupidly, comparing them to boxers. So, you know, it is what it is.
I gotta respond to Beats real quick. And he was talking about Pacquiao. They was putting Pacquiao in the same breath as Mayweather. Well, you got to realize Pacquiao beat a prime Morales and a prime Barrera. The best win on Mayweather's resume for a prime fighter was Diego Corrales.
Catchweight king. He never fought nobody in they full.
Not at a catchweight.
You know what I'm saying? Wait. He always fought every fight catchweight. Pacquiao did, and he was on that goddamn juice. Yeah.
So he never fought Ricky Hatton in his prime. Huh?
I said his best prime win was Diego Corrales.
No, he ain't. Ricky Hatton was considered a serious contender at that time.
You saying Ricky Hatton win was a better win than Diego Corrales?
It was a no. I'm from the UK, and I'm telling you, if you look at the odds making, it was fairly close. It wasn't no landslide, bro. It was pretty close, man, even to a 50-50 fight. Looking back on it, obviously not, but it was a 50-50 fight over in the UK. Ricky Hatton was undefeated. beat every man who ever stepped in the ring. That was his prime. What are you talking about here?
Okay, so beating the prime Ricky Hatton, is that a better win than beating the prime Morales and Barrera?
Yeah, hell yeah. Who cares? Who cares, man? Who cares? Maybe it was a team.
When did he finally beat Morales? With the third fight or something like that? I mean, didn't they fight 3 or 4 times? Come on, man. Shit. I wish y'all put Flores in his own fucking category. Let me tell you motherfuckers one more time. Flores is his own man. He's in his own category. Can't compare to him, man. 49-0. That's all I'm going to say.
Tell him, man. Took that size.
49-0.
See, the question
I don't care if they're in their prime or not. He be all world champion. 49-0.
Here's the question I'd reply and ask. Do you think all them guys you're talking about would have just went in the ring with Floyd like that? At them weights there? No, they wouldn't.
Shady. So
they would do, but they'd have to be getting paid a whole lot. A whole lot of money. I tell you, you'd see divas if Floyd called them out. You'd see divas. Because they know how, you might not know how good he is, but they know. They know. Pacquiao knows.
Pacquiao done. Go ahead, Beats.
Marquez knows.
Tell him. Rev up the engine. Yeah. Mike, hey, come on, Mike. Man, let's keep it moving. Everyone's quiet now.
Okay. Go ahead, Dudu.
I said, I'm listening. They talking about the motherfucking Floyd Mayweather. Do you know that's my motherfucking man? That's my motherfucking monkey, man. I've been watching Floyd since he came out the fucking Olympics. I'm like, okay, what? I just know he was guided. His career was so guided. It was smooth. He got out the game when he needed to get out the game. He fought when he knew he fought. That's just how it is. I'm sorry. If he didn't fight all motherfuckers in their prime when they were just coming, so what? At the end of the day, boxing is a business. And the man, and he fought world champion. He didn't fight no chump. They world champion. You feel me? Shit. Got the man's back.
Yeah. He didn't take no disrespect by jumping up weight classes.
Yeah, man. He was never called dirty. You know what I'm saying? He's the cleanest fighter. I don't know why.
I got cut off.
Go ahead.
Go ahead, Shady.
Yeah, Beast. Yeah, what was his question? I got cut off.
He was getting worked. That's what's going on. Beast, work him over again one more time.
Oh, damn.
No, just saying, like, you know, if you don't believe that a lot of fighters were ducking Floyd at that period, you probably weren't watching boxing. But, I mean, a lot of them guys...
Shane Mosley did duck Floyd. I know Mosley ducked him.
Right. Well, if you know that, well, you answered your own question. There's a reason they ducked him, and they weren't ducking Pacquiao like that. There's a reason. You might not know what the reason is, but there's a reason.
Oh, yeah, you got a good point, though.
He's a badass. That's what he is. He beat every man in front of him, and he's 49-0. Look back at it, boy. It's bad. Pacquiao making up lies over there, saying his shoulder, and now he's, you know, anyway, I ain't getting to it.
I mean, look, yeah, I've said it before. Y'all know I have my issues before and outside the ring, but in the ring, you can't doubt what he's done. You just cannot. People will say, well, he didn't fight this guy at this lower weight, he didn't fight this guy's lower weight, but the overall resume, nah, man. He's ATG for sure and high up on the ATG list. There's no doubt about it. There's no doubt about it. Let's move on. And I go to you on this one, Daniel. We were talking before the show. You were talking a possible opponent upcoming for Terrence Crawford, possibly Postal.
Well, this is what was happening right now. The way Bob Arum is trying to sell HBOs right now, he originally tried to sell Crawford and Provodnikov, and then with the Verdejo fight to pair those two up again, and then have Walters Lomachenko be paired up with Paul Stull. He's done a better job now. He's not pairing a Crawford fight and then putting up a Paul Stull fight next to it. And then putting the Walters fight and putting in Verdejo. Here's the issue, though. Lucas Matisse has not been declared out of the Canelo con card, and he was supposed to fight Mauricio Herrera. Mauricio Herrera wanted to fight, I think, Ruslan Provodnikov, and that's the opponent that Aaron wants for Crawford. I said it before, I said it again. If there's a time for Oscar to come in and screw with Bob, it is now. He could easily just slide a little bit more money. Hey, say, hey, Ruslan, come here. We'll get you a bigger, we'll get you on a pay-per-view. And you'll try to get revenge on a loss. And Herrera will get a good fight. That opens up a lot of windows because the fight you want to see now at 140 when it comes to Top Rank is Crawford versus Pasta. There's almost no excuse for it, the fight not to happen now. Except for the fact that maybe Aaron wants to marinate a little bit more and you have to sell it out. But that's gonna be what's different coming into it is if Golden Boy slides a little bit more money Provodnikov's way to have him reject Terrence Crawford and go fight Mauricio Herrera. I personally think Provodnikov probably was a little bit more signing to fight Crawford because he'll be fighting for the belt that he lost to Algeri. So he may want that belt back, but we'll have to wait and see.
Any response on that news from Daniel regarding Crawford and Postal and the possibility from anybody? Unmute your mic, folks.
Yeah, that's the fight I want to see, man. I want to see Crawford against Postal, but I don't know if it's going to be next. I doubt it's going to be the next fight.
It's going to be a good fight, though.
Well, it's a big problem that it's not the next fight, really, you know. I mean, why do I want to see Postal or Crawford struggle with some dudes who ain't got the skills to beat them? The only natural fight is for them to fight, you know. Why do I want to see Crawford beat up another Hank Lundy or Thierry Jones? It's a waste of potential of what the both two fights can do.
Well, now, according to the reports that are coming out of Golden Boy, and you have to decide whether you believe this or not, Eric Gomez, who's their matchmaker, told Dan Raphael that the reason Matisse is out is his call because his eye is still giving him problems. Remember, he lost to Postal saying that his eye was injured. So he's saying he's the one not ready to return.
That still opens up a lot of things, Gail.
It does. And first of all, you have to decide whether you believe that explanation on its face or not. But it means Matisse isn't part of this negotiation. So your scenario, not for the same reasons, perhaps, that we think, is still possible. And you're right. Golden Boy and Aram, although they're getting along okay. They have a marriage of convenience going on right now, and so far so good. They're getting along. I don't know if they want to bust up that good thing over this fight. You know, if they're going to destroy this detente they've got going on, you know, they're both all about making money. It'd have to be over something a little bigger. I don't think they're going to screw around with this one.
But to Beat's point, I agree with him on this one. Crawford and Postal is the fight that we all want to see. They're the two top fighters in the division right now. No need for them to toil around fighting other dudes unless a Crawford, they want to match Crawford up somehow against a Broner. But outside of that, I agree with Beats in the general assessment here. Crawford and Postal is the fight people want to see. Postal, in my opinion, at that weight, that's the biggest challenge for Terrence Crawford. And let's hope it happens sooner than later. Julio Cesar Chavez, in news that shouldn't be a surprise to anyone here, dropped out of his fight with Baudu Jack due to a quote-unquote heel injury. I'm sorry, anybody can chime in. I'm not buying it. We all know the story of how he broke from camp, was in the beach in Malibu somewhere. Again, I'm disgusted with this guy. I don't have much to say. Anybody else want to comment? If not, that's fine with me.
I think the injury's real. Maybe he was running on the beach, you know. Sometimes the sand's a little rough. Anything can happen out there on the beach, man. No, it's BS. Of course, he pulled out because he wasn't going to win the fight. Baudu Jack won't put that asshole on.
Nah, man, I believe him. I believe him, man. You know, I don't think he ever lied.
Are you smoking what he's smoking?
Nah, he never lied.
Apparently, Chavez is sharing his weed now.
No. I believe him. I think, you know, legit, and they're going to reschedule the fight, and that's it, man.
It is ridiculous. And finally, after all this time, Senior calls his son out. And that had to take a lot for Chavez Senior to publicly dress his son down. He has backed him up. He's covered for him. He begged Freddie Roach to keep him on. Freddie trained Chavez Jr. as long as he did, only out of respect to Chavez Sr. I think when he saw his son quit on the stool against Fanfara last summer, I think right there and then the light switch flipped and he finally said, I've had enough. But he kept his cool. He didn't air it out in public until this latest shenanigans. You know, Chavez is not motivated. He doesn't have the work ethic. He's got all the natural talent, thanks to the DNA God as a gift, but he's done nothing with it. And nobody should be spending another dime or another minute of conversation on that kid. And well, and I won't after this. I'm done.
Sorry. I don't even think he has the talent that his father has. Not even close.
No, he doesn't. And it's unlikely they're going to reschedule the fight because Bannon Jacks is coming up to 6 months without defending. The IBF have actually wrote him a letter, so he's due to defend the belt. So they're going to look for another opponent. Like Chavez is saying, hopefully May. They can't rely on that. And hopefully it may, you know. Because the guy's unreliable. He's a bit of a flick. So.
Yeah, and as far as believing them, hell, this is the same Chavez Jr. who thought he was ahead in the Fanfara fight before he quit. Then he claimed he didn't quit. So, no.
He was, though. And he was beating Martinez as well, like, on the scorecards.
Okay, you're trolling right now, Adrian. Do you want to get muted, sir? Do you want to get muted, sir?
I think it's time for Chavez to get a DNA test on his son to see if he's his kid, man. That's what I think. Next step is DNA test, man. That's what I'm saying.
Oh, man. A bit like
Aidan's baby. It don't even look like him. Aidan's baby.
Hey, listen, Chavez lost credibility when they stripped Martinez of the belt and gave it Chavez. It was over for me, man. I was on his ass from then, bro.
Absolutely. Let's start shutting the show down because we're running really long here. Talk about some fights in the weekend. David Lemieux is fighting over the weekend. Flanagan and Matthews in a title fight. Beats, EJ, do y'all consider that a domestic fight like Quigg and Frampton?
Go ahead, Beats.
Well, Flanagan and Matthews?
Yeah.
One British title fight, really. But, you know, they keep showing replays of him knocking out old Nate Campbell, which is good, you know, but... Yeah, I don't know, man. Look, if they really want to prove themselves to be some great fighters, do what James Miguel has done and go across the pond and go and fight some proper fighter. I mean, that's all I can say, man.
But the problem is, Beats, when you look at the lightweight landscape, what's there?
Linares, Felix Verdejo. There's guys there. There's what's his name again? Ivan Mendy, the one who beat Luke Campbell. There's guys out there waiting for them. They need to step up, man. You can't be that fight there. Listen, bro, I wouldn't waste your time. I'm gonna watch it though. I wouldn't tell anyone. What you need to be watching, the biggest upset of the weekend. I'm gonna tell you right now. Saddam Andam faces Patrick Mendy over here from Reading, England. He's gonna upset Andam. Trust me, man. He's a massive underdog. He's only got one knockout on his record. And he will upset Saddam Hassan Andam.
You said Hassan Andam?
Yeah, he's fighting on the weekend against Patrick Mendy.
Wait. If you can't knock him down, you can't win a fight. I mean, you're not going to beat a fight, you don't knock him down, man.
He won't win the fight. And he's a massive underdog, but I've got him winning that fight. That's the biggest upset of the week. Zab Judah's fighting on the card. Is it CBS card as well? So you guys will check out for that as well.
Okay. I'm not moved by that Judah fight. I'm sorry.
Oh, man. I don't blame you.
You know what, Zeb?
That's a world-class fight. He's going against Josh Torres. Josh Torres is a tough, gritty component, man. Hey, listen, Zab Judah, this should be a good fight, man. It's free.
The Ndam fight, at least, you know, to me, he's more relevant at middleweight than Judah is at welterweight. And for me, Ndam, to Hakim's point, when he doesn't get knocked down, he's a damn good boxer. He's highly skilled.
Yeah, I mean, they were trying to say he was supposed to be the next Parnell Whitaker. But another guy on the undercard is me and Beats interviewed him. Leon Spinks the third, the slickster southpaw at lightweight. He's going against Jesus, Jesus Guerrero. I don't know what his name is.
There you go. There you go. You know what it is.
Soto Caras?
Nah, but Leon Spinks is the next jinx in the link of greatness. Trust me, you need to watch out for him. Leon Spinks.
I'm more interested in the Tete bout on the Matthews Flanagan undercard.
That's a good fight. That's a good fight. Tete versus Jose Santos Gonzalez. You know about this guy? I've never heard of him before.
I don't know much about him. I have to find some video of him, but I'm more interested in Tete and how he looks. Post Butler. I mean, he's had a couple of fights in South Africa since then, but I want to see how he looks in Saturday night.
Yeah. I mean, I've got the record right now of the guy, Jose Santos Gonzalez. He got 22 wins with 12 knockouts. He's got 3 losses. He ain't got no notable names on his record. He fights out of Mexico, so I don't know, man. His last fight, he actually lost that cheap by a unanimous decision. So he might be durable.
He may be.
And if IBF belt, man, international belt. He had that belt already. Was he bantamweight before though?
Zelante Tete, he had the junior bantamweight belt, the IBF version, but they stripped him because, quite frankly, he wasn't getting the money. They didn't offer. It was because of money. He didn't, you know. So.
Yeah, so he's moved up. Yeah, so this is for international belt, but England might have the card of the weekend maybe.
You just mentioned Soto Caras. They're matching him up against that camera guy. So they're looking for a slugfest in California with that one, man.
Oh, that's going to be beautiful.
If I was Jesse Vargas, I would fight the winner of that fight.
No, Mike. Mike, no.
Yeah, I would say no.
No, man.
That's not too much risk, too little reward there. Damned entertaining, but a bad idea.
He'd get a lot of street cred, though.
And he'll lose it once he gets knocked out by either one of them.
I don't think you cash street cred at the bank, though. Damn.
I'm just saying, if he wins, a lot of street cred there.
Hey, yeah. you guys hear Miguel Cotto may be fighting James Kirkland.
Nope. That's why I didn't talk about it. Just nope.
I got James Kirkland winning that fight.
You're talking about boxing. I heard this gonna be pay per view as well. Look,
if
man,
he's got Wolf,
that's the problem. That's the problem. That fight shouldn't be pay per view.
With Ann Wolf in the corner, it should be always pay per view. Trust me.
James Kirkland wins with Ann Wolf.
Ann Wolf and Teddy Atlas, the fireman. When the fireman comes and when Ann Wolf comes, trust me, it's pay per view. She gets the best out of Kirkland. And Teddy Atlas is good.
It's not Batman or Robin. She gets the best out of Kirkland if Kirkland is relatively active, yeah? She even said herself she wouldn't have took the Canelo fight. She wouldn't have put him in that hard. Like, she needs a long period, like, adjusting to a fighter-coach relationship, right? The only reason that they're trying to get Ann Wolf on board so they can sell the fight. I even see someone in the comment section. If Ann Wolf is in the corner, I'm going to bet on Kirkland. What for? It's 2016. Kirkland just got messed up real bad. You know what I mean? Ann Wolf ain't Superwoman.
He had a year layoff. Let him get like a little tiny fight before the...
But the problem is, I think this is where Beast is going. Excuse me if I'm speaking for y'all to turn. It's not just a physical thing vis-a-vis James Kirkland. It's mental and psyche with him.
Well,
yeah, it is.
Even beyond that, right? I see him get flatlined, right? At least let this guy have one fight, and let's see how he is before an elite fighter takes him on. It's absolutely crazy for Cotto to fight that guy after we see him prostrate on the canvas like that, man. That's crazy. Doesn't make sense.
But it's a gimme fight. That's the point.
I know. Ann Wolf got paid when he fought Canelo, though.
Yes, she did.
She got paid when he fought Canelo. She's like his manager or something. She got paid. Even though she didn't train him, he didn't want to go with her, she got paid.
Yeah, she ain't no dummy in that regard, so I'll tip my hat to her for
that
alone.
That Dr. Dre Easy E thing, he's still going to get that money.
Oh,
exactly.
I was just watching Beef too.
You should have went with her though, but I don't think it would have made no difference.
I agree. I think we're going to shut the show down on that note. I'm going to go around the hangout here, give folks time to prop their own thing. I'm starting with ladies first. Doodoo MF and Brown. For folks who want to talk boxing or anything.
Doodoo motherfucking Brown, why you ain't standing there? Now you can't say you can't cuss, motherfucker. You a saint?
No.
What's good? Because you were saying motherfucking Brown before, and all of a sudden now, MF Brown.
Look here, ma'am. I don't have to cuss on every show. That's my prerogative.
Shit, I ain't saying you have to cuss on every show. All I'm saying is, oh, you didn't flip the script.
Nah, sister. I just don't decide to cuss on every show. But anyway, for folks who want to talk boxing or anything else, let the folks know where they can find you.
I'm going to buy me a computer. I'm going to start my own motherfucking show. I did before I got on your show in the first place. I'm going to start my own shit. Like, I know boxing. I know I'm boxing. I know all about goddamn boxing. I feel like I just, y'all make me come in there. I come in these groups with y'all. Y'all just make me motherfuckers kind of feel kind of stupid like they don't know what the fuck they talking about. Because y'all throw up numbers and shit, but y'all actually don't know besides EJ, but I know he's been in the ring because I seen photos of him. None of y'all motherfuckers have a fuck. Motherfucker ain't even had a street fight. Pussy ass nigga.
Trevor!
Alright, I'm going to let her get away with it just because she did. One.
I love y'all though. Good night.
Yeah, seriously though. First of all, just because we disagree with you don't mean you don't know your stuff. You do. That's number one. Secondly,
I know my shit. I don't care what y'all say.
You know, disagreement doesn't make us feel you stupid. Quite the contrary. For folks who want to talk boxing, let the folks know where they can find you.
And you find me anyway. Just put in Doodoo Brown, and I'll pop up. Just Google me. That's all you gotta do.
Gail Falkenthal, Community Digital News. For folks who want to talk boxing or anything else, let the folks know where they can find you.
You can find me and my column on Communities Digital News at com, digi news, and the interwebs, the Twitter, and all that stuff. You know, and like Doodoo, you got to Google my name, except you got to be able to spell mine. Good luck with that.
Boxing Beats and Rhymes, EJ Boxing Live. Join us live from the UK. For folks who want to talk boxing and whatnot, let the folks know where they can find you.
Yeah, man. Find me on YouTube, Boxing Beats and Rhymes, Facebook, Boxing Beats and Rhymes, The Black Boxer, Facebook, Twitter, Boxing Beats and Rhymes. I'm there.
EJ Boxing Live.
EJ Boxing Live here. EJ Boxing Live here.
Motherfucker!
Yo, man. I'm keeping it funny, man. No. Anyway, you can find me on Twitter. At Errol Jarrett or EJ Boxing Live, and you catch me on YouTube, EJ Boxing Live. Beach has a hangout on Sunday. You can catch me on there every Sunday, and I do predictions every week, and or post straight after any big fights this weekend, which there is none. So you might not catch me on the hangout this weekend, but Hakeem and Scorsese, Umar, Mike occasionally comes over, and Daniel as well.
Blocker.
What's blocker? What's that mean? I don't even know what that means, right? Like, how can
you? Oh, no, you try to speak patois for us, son?
He's trying to say,
go watch a rap battle in New York. You'll see what I mean.
That's cool. Yeah, he's trying to give me props. Yeah, so you can catch me there, UK. And I'm not a UK hater. I like our UK fighters. Is that I only believe in the best. And Kell Brook and some of the others are not doing it. So I'm going to give you that's it.
Yeah. For Hakeem Boxer, for folks who want to talk the sweet science or anything else, let the folks know where they can find you.
You can find me pretty much anywhere you find EJ, to be honest with you. If you find EJ, you'll probably find me. I'm always on Hangout. EJ is like the big homie of Google Hangouts for me, so if you find EJ, you'll find me.
And stay away from the popos, man. Stay away from the popos.
You know what? One roll past me when I come back on. I went roll right past me, kept falling slow behind me, like by 15 yards behind me. I'm going 40, trying not to even go an inch over 40 miles per hour because I knew he was going to pull me over.
Stay woke, bro. Stay woke. For Daniel Carpio, for folks who want to talk box or anything else, let the folks know where to find you.
Yeah. Okay, you can find me on Twitter, Ruckus99. Like I said, tweet a lot. I do some stories on the Inscriber, talk boxing, talk NBA. And definitely, like I said, I do have a show on Sunday with the folks at 4Boxing News. They weren't able to join us this evening. But like I said, we do shows every Sunday. We recap it. All the weekend's fights that we can, and we also cover boxing news. And like I said, any all welcome to come in anytime.
Absolutely. I want to also thank Dill, Shady Slim, who else joined us? Some other folks who joined us also during the show. Jacob, I should say, for joining us on the show.
Nalter and Miguel, you know,
Nalter. Yeah, I had to kick, I'm sorry, Nalter and Miguel, I had to kick you all off because there was too many folks in the hangout and folks who was here earlier, they couldn't get back on, so I apologize for that. For folks who want to talk boxing and whatnot, y'all know what it is, Brother JR on Twitter, at BrotherJR76. Again, for folks who want to talk, who want to find information on Pound for Pound Boxing Report, p4pboxingreport.wordpress.com. That's the link for the blog. You look to the Rather blog page. Links to find us all over the interwebs, all over social media, Facebook, G+, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, Pinterest, RSS feed for the show. If you want to check, subscribe there. Links to find us on Podomatic, Stitcher Radio, Flipboard Magazine, SoundCloud, iTunes, as well as the email address, p4pboxingrpt@gmail.com. Next week, we're going to do a preview of Andre Ward returning to the ring to fight Sullivan Barrera. EJ's boy, Kell Brook, he's going to be fighting that same night over in England against Kevin Bizier. so we're going to talk about those fights and any other news and events that's going to happen in the interim. So for Doodoo Brown, for Gail Falkenthal, Boxing Beats and Rhymes, EJ Boxing Live, Daniel Carpio, Hakim Boxing, and everybody else who joined us, I am Michael. This has been another episode of the Pound for Pound Box Report. You guys have a good evening. Good night.
Good night.
Yeah, beat stick.